This is where you win games. Right here. Instead of worrying about how tired you are, you got to embrace the pain and find a way. Tough, tough, tough. Tough. We're just going to beat people down. No tricks. The offense don't work unless you're tough. The defense don't work unless you're tough. Tough, tough, tough. Embrace the pain. You start winning now. This is where you win. Right here. Tough. 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 I don't care how long or how hard. You got to be able to go. Y'all got to be able to go. Huh? Yeah. I don't know if I'm
you're watching ESPNU College Football Primetime, presented by McDonald's. We're at Armstrong Stadium on the campus of Hampton University for Homecoming 2010 as the Wildcats of Bethune-Cookman University bring its unbeaten record north to take on the Hampton University Pirates. Let's check out the MEAC standing. Bethune is 8-0 overall, 5-0 in the conference, while Hampton is in a three-way tie for second with South Carolina State and Florida A&M at 4-1. Hello, everyone. Charlie Neal, along with my partner, former Howard University and NFL quarterback Jay Walker. Welcome to Hampton University. And, Jay, this is a championship game for all practical purposes. If you remember back in 2002, Bethune-Cookman came into the stadium, in Armstrong Stadium, unbeaten with 9 straight wins. And the team that knocked them off that year was Hampton University. This is a big game for both of these teams again today.
And I think we understand why Coach Brian Jenkins emphasizes toughness. We know they've got an outstanding offense that can score points, but it's the mental toughness that's going to be required to come in here today to beat the Pirates on their homecoming.
And when you look at this Bethune team, they have a lot of weapons, but it all starts with a quarterback by the name of Matt Johnson.
Yeah, if you're going to have an offense that you call the Speedway offense, I don't care how great it is, you're going to need somebody to rev up those engines. Bethune-Cookman, that young driver is Matt Johnson. Accounts for over 275 yards per game on offense. He's got 2,200 yards on the season. He's the guy that hits the throttle to rattle the Wildcats' engine's offense.
All right, it's going to be interesting. When you talk about this Hampton University team, their offense has been slow getting started this year. That means today the defense cannot afford to give up points to Bethune early.
Fortunately for Hampton, if you're relying on your defense, it's good to have what many people believe to be the defensive player of the year in the MEAC Conference. His name, Kendrick Ellis. 6'5", 300-plus pounds of football passion. The leading tackler on this Pirate squad. If Kendrick Ellis has a big day today, look for the Pirates to have a chance to slow down the Speedway offense.
There's Brian Jenkins, the new and first-year head coach of the Wildcats of Bethune-Cookman University. Last year, he was an assistant under Greg Schiano up at Rutgers. And let's talk about his game plan with you, Professor Jay.
Yeah, the lesson plan for Bethune, you know, they score 44 points a game. I don't know if you need that to win in a championship-type environment. They need to get 30 points, and they must stay disciplined on defense. No more cheap penalties, hold pass interference. So let's see if they have the defensive discipline required to win.
On the other side, Donovan Rose in his second year, he played his collegiate ball here at Hampton University, and there you see his record this season. And also, let's talk about the lesson plan for Hampton University.
They've got to control the clock, win the time of possession. Don't look for an explosive offense, but more so a methodical offense, moving the ball down the field to keep the Wildcats offense on the sideline. And I like this one on defense. Number 13, who's the quarterback for Bethune-Cookman, Matt Johnson, they need to get at least 13 hits on him to have a chance to execute their defensive game plan.
And as you see, the ball on the tee. Hampton won the toss, deferred. They'll get the ball to start the second half. Bethune-Cookman in their white jerseys will get the opening kickoff. This is Courtney Keith feeling it at about the 18-yard line. Has some running room across midfield. Downs inside the kicker and is finally bounced out of bounds on the near sideline. But a great return for Bethune-Cookman to start this game off. Here's Courtney Keith, the sophomore out of Eustis, Florida, who's averaging 23 yards per kickoff return, and what a way to get started, Jay.
I mean, that's something that you just can't have in this type of environment. Coach Donovan Rose, He was a special teams coach here for many years at Hampton before he took over as the head coach. And they've been hurting a little bit, struggling on special teams play. And Bethune showing you one thing about Florida, no matter how tough they are, we know the one thing that they got in Florida are athletes that can run. You saw it right there on the kickoff return.
And they get the ball first and 10 at the 20-yard line. As you look at Matt Johnson, he's just been Mr. Everything this year for this Bethune-Cookman squad, a senior out of Fort Lauderdale, Florida, and he's going to throw on first down, and it's in and out of the hands of the intended receiver, and that is Tony Wilson. Let's look at the offense for Bethune-Cookman. We talked about Matt Johnson, the quarterback. Look at Jonathan Moman. He's the running back there. He gets the start today. He is back from some sprained knee problems, and then on the offensive side of the line is guards Gould and West. They're seniors up front, blocking the way. This time, Andros Bell on the carry straight ahead, and Bell gets about 4 or 5 yards. Let's look at the defense for Hampton University. Kendrick Ellis is the man in the middle. We already talked about him. As far as the linebacker is concerned, a couple of good ones. The middle anchored by Darius Johnson, and then he's the number four tackler in the conference. And then watch out for Brandon McGee. He's a stopper. And in the secondary, Ricardo Silver leads the Hampton Pirate defense with 4 interceptions. It is second down, make that third down, third and about 7. Throwing into the wind, throwing an out route on the far side, trying to get it to Mr. Poole over there. Or is that Francois? That is Francois, Maurice Francois, who last year was a quarterback in this offense. And we have a player shaking up on the field for Bethune-Cookman. Let's see, that's Rozier. Marvell Rozier.
Yeah, the right tackle. Let's take a look on the right side of your screen. And he's got his man. Oh, see what happened there? It happens so often in football. He's concentrating on blocking his man and got rolled up on the backside. Another defender there. That's a tough one right there if you lose your opening right tackle on the drive. Wow.
And you talk about this potent offense of Bethune-Cookman. Now, let's see if they go for it on fourth down. Last week, they had all kinds of issues in terms of kicking the game, kicking the ball and field goals in this particular offense. And let's see what they do today. When you look at the two teams and you compare them in terms of total yards, you see Bethune-Cookman with over 200 more yards per game than Hampton University offensively.
Yeah, and that's something that they're going to have to get it going. You know, for Bethune-Cookman, you know, you can't change overnight. If you think that you've got your offense you can hang your hat on, well, you need them to go down and not settle for field goals like it seems like they're going to do. You know, in a conference game, championship game, you can't go in there and think you're going to beat possibly the best team in your conference or the second best team in your conference, scoring 44 points like you've done on everybody else.
Mm-hmm.
So I think, you know, the importance for Bethune is to realize, have realistic expectations offensively on what you want to achieve point-wise and allow your defense to make a couple plays and turnovers to keep you in the game and help you clinch that championship that you're trying to achieve.
This is Corey Kowalski. He has not made a field goal this year. He's 0 for 3. Now the other kicker, Sven Hurd, has been banged up. So Kowalski, who's normally the punter, is in to attempt the field goal. This will be about a 33-yard field goal attempt out of the hole of Troy Danhauer. The kick is up. It has the distance, and it is no good, off to the right. So he has still struggled trying to kick field goals. Corey Kowalski, the sophomore from Rockledge, Florida.
Yeah, you know, one thing I saw during the pregame, Coach Jenkins was watching every kick that they attempted. You see, it didn't go for naught from around the same range. I sat there and actually saw Kowalski miss 7 out of 10 field goals from that exact distance with the head coach watching every single kick. I mean, right in his circle, in his line of vision. So all that practice in the pregame didn't pay off. They knew they had a problem. And look at this, Carl. How often do you see a Florida team bring the band up to the north?
This is big.
This is big for Bethune-Cookman to do that. That lets you know what they've got riding on this game. They don't want any excuses, and they are committed to trying to clinch this championship.
Herbert Bynes gets the starting quarterback today, and here's Chisholm on the right side. He carries for about 7 or 8 yards. Normally, David Legree is the quarterback of record for the Hampton Pirates, but he is banged up. And Bynes, no stranger to this offense. A couple of years ago, he set all kinds of school records at that quarterback position for the Hampton Pirates. So you see his career stats right there. There's Mr. Legree on the sideline. He's got knee problems, a couple of other issues. He can play, he said, if he has to. Here's a pass out the flat to Thomas, Isaiah Thomas, and he gets the first down. And he's up across the 35 to about the 36-yard line. As you look at the Hampton University offense, We talked about Antoine Chisholm, the true freshman, just carried the ball a few plays ago. They want to get him the ball off of the day. As far as the offensive line, they've been banged up, but Michael Ola has managed to stay healthy on that offensive line for the Pirates. First down and 10. Ball at the 35. Bynes from the shotgun. He'll keep it this time. Running to the near sideline. Finally brought down from behind, but not before he got some pretty good yardage. As we look at Bethune Cookman's defense, a defensive line led by Ryan Davis, a preseason all-conference selection. As far as the linebackers are concerned, Ryan Lewis leads the team in tackles. He also has three interceptions this year, while in the secondary, R.K. Smith is the leader back there with four picks to his credit. Dead ball foul, illegal substitution, and this is against Hampton University. That'll be a five-yard penalty. So instead of first and 10, it'll be first and 15 as the ball is moved back at about the 42-yard line.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see if that penalty will come back to haunt the Pirates, considering they just picked up a first down, getting ready to cross midfield. Now you're adding an extra 5 yards against a defense that's trying to find their way and trying to make a stop.
Herbert Bynes, senior from Fort Lauderdale, Florida. Here comes the blitz, but they pick it up pretty good, trying to get to the right side. It's Chisholm, but they will not let him get there. Will not let him turn the corners. Chris Perry, number 30, came up to make the stop.
You know, one thing we like about Antoine Chisholm, he averages 5 yards a carry, but he's just a freshman. As a freshman, when you know they're bringing the blitz and they're getting pressure, you don't want to go sideways. You want to run right to the hole. And if that hole's not there, that crease is not there immediately, then just get down on the ground. You can't afford to lose yardage.
So they lose a few more yards on that play, maybe a 2 or 3. That'll bring up second and about 18. Second and 18. We were talking about quarterbacks. You look at Isaiah Thomas there, the junior out of Dunbar High in Washington, D.C. He would be the third quarterback should something happen to Bynes and Legree couldn't go. There's a timeout on the field. No score in Hampton.
When you join together talented student athletes with great coaches.
ESPNU College Football Primetime is presented by McDonald's. I'm loving it. And in part by 5-Hour Energy. Hours of energy now, no 2:30 feeling later. For more information, visit 5hourenergy.com.
There's three things that we're going to do this game. Three things. Be physical. That's what it is. They ain't seen that. That's all we're doing. All we're doing is just taking it to them right away. If we get the ball, we're kicking that thing off. We're going to go down there and make it happen, guys. This out day, keep your head up the whole time, encourage one another. Let's go get this thing. First place on the line. First place is on the line. Let's bring it up, baby. Bring it up. Let's go.
First place is on the line, Jay. You see Donovan Rose. He said, but there's 24 seniors on this team. He has still seen his team to play a complete game this season, and he hopes that it comes through today.
Yeah, that's a tough part, trying to find your identity this late in the season. And you take a look, I mean, he's just been at Hampton forever.
Right. He was played here, was assistant here twice. Yeah. Then he came back and became the head coach. And there the quarterback falls down. Chisholm goes to the right side. That's Chisholm or McLeod. McLeod, number 32 is Chisholm.
Yeah, that's Chisholm running the freshman, getting most of the carries. But let's go back to what we heard both coaches say. You know, we saw the open, and what was Brian Jenkins saying? Tough. We saw Coach Rose in the locker room. What was he saying? Physical.
Right.
Now, for as many points as you won, and I love offense more than anybody else, both programs realize to win a championship, you need defense, you need to play tough and physical, terms that are used to describe the defensive side of the football.
Bynes working out of the shotgun. This is a 3rd and 12 situation for Hampton. Again, Chisholm on the carry straight ahead. Gains yards right up to the midfield stripe, where it'll be 4th and about 8.
And it goes back to that penalty they got for an illegal substitution, which I call a mental error on 1st and 10. Don't even get the playoff, and next thing you know, you're looking at 1st and 15, and they're able to dictate the conditions in which you run your offense. So when you're trying to go out there and seal the deal, win a championship, I don't think you can afford to have too many of those mental errors.
Yeah. This is going to run out of bounds at about the 25-yard line. Don't forget, catch BCS Countdown Sunday and Monday nights on ESPNU. First Sunday night at 9 Eastern, catch an exclusive look at the latest BCS poll. Then Monday night at 6 Eastern, our experts provide an in-depth analysis of the week and a look ahead to Week 11. BCS Countdown, presented by Discover on ESPNU, Sunday and Monday. For more information, log on to ESPNU.com. Charlie Neal, Jay Walker here in Hampton for Homecoming 2010. Great day for football. Second possession for Bethune. Here's a pass out into the near side, and it is caught by Isidore Jackson. Three touchdowns for him last week. From a running perspective, now he catches one coming out of the backfield.
You know, everybody talks about Matt Johnson and his legs, but look at the pocket presence. Finds a throwing lane in which to deliver the ball, catchable ball in stride to allow Jackson to get some yards after catch. And, you know, one thing we've got to allude to, you know, I think on the FCS level, this Bethune-Cookman offense is like the Blur. You know, I love that nickname, the Blur, what they call the Oregon offense out there, just scoring a point a minute almost. And, you know, when Bethune is rolling on all cylinders, they can beat you in so many ways. They can throw the football, they can run the football with their running game, or they can also just allow their quarterback, Matt Johnson, to improvise. It all comes down to the decision-making. Offensive coordinator Mark Orlando has done a good job of bringing in this new offensive philosophy and having great success.
Here's a handoff straight into the gut, and they pick up the first down by keeping the ball on the ground. And again, that is Isidore Jackson on the carry for Bethune-Cookman. You know, one of the things both coaches talk about is forget about what we did in September and October. People only remember what you did in November.
November is when you win championships. It's like you can play great in the preseason, but what are you going to do when you get in conference play?
First down and 10, Bethune. Johnson to pass, has a complete, and it's Javon Reams. Reams gets the first down, and he's in Hampton territory down to the 45-yard line.
Yeah, I mean, you know, just a curl flat combination, and look at the pocket presence. Nice little wall around him, and he stands tall in the pocket, although he's very slight in size, 5'11", 180 pounds, but thrown to a big target out there in Reams. Easy throw, easy catch.
And they get the ball, get rid of the ball quick, and again, this is Isidore Jackson on the carry. Was that Kendrick Ellis on the stop defensively?
You know, this is the FCS version of the Blur.
Oh,
I mean, that's a lot of offense there. Almost 500 yards per game of total offense. And
44 points per contest also.
Yeah. And we've seen them put some good points on some good defensive squads. I mean, Delaware State plays good defense year and out. Morgan State plays good defense
Hampton
year in, year out. So only one team slowed them down.
And that was South Carolina State. And there's the quarterback sack. And unusually occurrence for Bethune-Cookman offensively, only the 16th time this year they've been sacked, and it was Copeland who came up with the sack.
Yeah, and you see that. They had bodies going all over the pocket there, just collapsing the pocket, and at the end, Copeland was there to finish it off.
Copeland's a true freshman out of Bethel High right here in Hampton, Virginia, bringing up a third down and 14 now for the Wildcats of Bethune. And flags fly. Do we have illegal motion? Comes in from the head linesman. What do we have offsides? This is going to take a while to sort out for whatever reason. It's just an offside penalty.
And I thought I saw Brandon Pegasi.
Pegues,
sorry, jump offside. I was pretty sure he got a big jump on the ball.
To the snap, offside, defense in the neutral zone, 5-yard penalty, third down.
So it'll bring up a third and 9 as opposed to a third and 14.
And that's one of those, you know, those mental errors you have right there. You're jumping offside on a team, you got them in third and long, and now all of a sudden you give them third and 10, third and 9, which is much more attainable than third and 10 plus yards.
So again, from the shotgun, Matt Johnson works with Isidore Jackson alongside of him. Jackson stays in and blocks. And here's a pass.
Got a guy open.
Francois drops it in the end zone. The former quarterback, Maurice Francois, wide open in the end zone. All he had to do was bring it in, and he let it go. So the bring up a fourth down punting situation. Good blocking inside.
Look at the spin move, Charlie. Look, that's a classic spin move by Matt Johnson. Get outside, buy some time, and this is a touchdown throw. You know, they're upset at the sideline. There was some yelling at the quarterback, but what a great throw. This is a touchdown. All he has to do is see it in, and oh!
Right in his hands.
Come on,
can't get any better than
you were a former quarterback.
Yes, indeed.
You know you got to come down with that ball.
He was a quarterback last year on this team. Here's a fake. And the punter will not get to the first down marker. They faked it on the fake punt on fourth down, and the punter, Corey Kowalski, decides to run it. But he didn't show a whole lot of determination, did he? We'll be back. No score in Hampton.
People choose 5-Hour Energy over 7 million times a week for lots of reasons. It's a nutritional supplement that...
No score here in the 16th meeting between Hampton University and Bethune-Cookman. 9-6, Hampton has the edge, but they've lost the last two, and here's that fourth down play, Jay.
The Corey Kozlowski's not having a good day at the office. He missed the field goal earlier. Now on the fake punt, he's got room to run. Just go to your left. Go to your... Why'd you run right on the back of your blocker, Darkevis Fields? If you go to the left, you could have run for 20-plus yards. I guess that's why they're kickers and punters. See, they wonder why they get a bad rap. Well, running the football like that, you'll continue to get a bad rap.
Here's a reverse. Isaiah Thomas going around the right side. And Isaiah Thomas down the sidelines. Short of a first down, stepped out of bounds at about the 46-yard line. So he'll be about 3 yards shy of the first down.
Yeah, they're going to do the reverse right here. Chisholm's going to do a little flip to Isaiah Thomas. Thomas does a little play-action pass, like, I can throw this. So it was a run-pass option for Isaiah Thomas, and then just turned on the jets and get upfield to pick up positive yard and stepped out of bounds just a little bit shy of the first down marker.
Well, he actually has completed a pass. He's only thrown two this year, but he completed one for a 19-yard touchdown earlier this season, so he can throw the ball.
And I think their plan is to get him involved in the offense. We've seen him take a snap in the Wildcat early in this contest. Now they're giving the ball on the reserves. So look for Isaiah Thomas to be important to this Pirate offense.
And straight ahead, again, they're keeping the ball on the ground with the little guys between McLeod and Chisholm. That time is Chisholm, the freshman, three-time Rookie of the Week.
Yeah, you see Chisholm hitting the hole very hard and fast, and that's why they really like him. That's why he averages over 5 yards per carry. You know, on another note, you know he's not going to be intimidated by Bethune-Cookman. Florida guys aren't scared of other Florida guys or intimidated by him, so he's excited to play.
They're going to call ball
start.
A false start.
Offense, number 32. 5-yard foul.
Chisholm moved a little prematurely, and that's one of those freshman mistakes.
Yeah, and that's a freshman mistake because if you're in the backfield and you jump forward offside, you can just keep motion and act like you're going in motion. But he didn't pick up on that when he took the lean step forward and then stopped. And they got him for the offside, but he should have just acted like he was going in motion. He would have been okay.
This time, quarterback keeps it. And he has dropped for a loss. You know, one of the things when you talk to Brian Jenkins that concerns him was all the yards he gave up to North Carolina A&T. Even though they won 67-17, they gave up over 250 yards of rushing.
I'm willing to give him a pass, though. I mean, anytime you have an hour and 45-minute delay in the first quarter, you know, it took your defense a little while to rev back up.
Yeah, and it was 17 or 19-0 at the time, I believe. Here's Bynes, a little out pass. Here's Chisholm trying to break tackles and trying to get to that first down marker, struggles, but it's going to come up about 5 yards shy down at the 41-yard line. That was a third and 15 situation that'll bring up fourth down.
So, you know, it was that extra effort. I mean, take a look at where he catches this ball and where the initial contact is made. Missed tackle there. Then he's going to get 5 more extra yards right now in that pile you see there just by spinning around there. And by doing that, he puts his team in a position to give himself third and short compared to having to go for third and 10. That completely changes the offensive play selection when you've got third and less than 5 yards.
That was a second down play. Now it's third down, and this one's knocked down, almost intercepted by Sandilands, who got his hands on it, number 11 there. Senior out of Northwestern High in Miami, Florida. He has a fumble recovery, preseason second team all selection this season.
Not a good start for Hampton. I mean, you've got an offense that you know is going to score points before the day is over, they've gone down twice your side of the field and walked away with 0 points, and you don't make them pay for it. So it's still a tie game. You're Hampton University. Got to be disappointed you don't have any points on the board this early in the contest.
South Carolina State final score was 10-7 when these two teams, that is Hampton and South Carolina State, went at it as Courtney Keith calls for a fair catch. 5:17 remaining. First quarter, still no score on homecoming.
From an early age, Timothy Richmond understood that with knowledge comes confidence. In junior high, while abroad,
check it out. Go to bedean.com now and start playing.
Now, I know a way to get more people to visit your site. Mm-hmm. Give yourself a band auditorium. So you can have like 400 members in the band, like Bethune Cookman and some of the larger black colleges do. And that's how you build a program now.
People want to see the band. I know that's what you would do if you would have done.
Yeah, I think, you know, if the band is good enough, I would give out band scholarships. You know, some of them be full ride. I'm not giving Piccolo full ride. You know, I'll give them some meals.
Like you don't want to give Kickers a full ride,
no,
right?
No way.
And now we've got a delay. A clock malfunction, I believe.
I mean, you know that the Be the Dean, I mean, you know that's like the fastest growing thing on Facebook right now?
Play. Set the play clock to 25 seconds. There is no foul for delay of game.
So I had to go out and learn how to play that. You know what it is? You build a program and you want visitors to your site, almost
right.
Like you want recruits to come visit your mm-hmm. university. You don't expect that from a potent offense like Bethune Cookman, only 36 yards and 2 possessions.
Isidore Jackson with the carry, and met by a host of blue defensive jerseys from Hampton University, but he manages to pick up about 5 or 6 yards up across the 20 to about the 21-yard line.
Talking to defensive coordinator from Hampton University, Keith Gilganis, who played linebacker at Penn State and also in the National Football League, he said, we're going to be willing to sacrifice allowing the running back to beat us because we're not going to let Matt Johnson beat us. We're going to hit him when he's got to make that read option. He better be reading the pitcher because we're going to hit him.
Reams was the man in motion, and
there it is.
They got him.
Nobody was on the pitch, man, or the ride.
And that
man.
Was Pegues who was there to bring him down, number 33.
I mean, that was a game plan. You know, we talked about the hits on Johnson. He said, we're going to take that out of his hands. So get rid of it. He needs to get rid of it. They've got guys waiting on him. So,
yeah, they were there.
Good call early by the Pirate defense and deciding to attack the quarterback rather than allow the quarterback to make a decision on what he's going to do with the football.
Third down and 9 now for this Bethune-Cookman team, who's been about 49% effective on third down situations throughout the season. Back to pass, and now a flag. False start against Bethune.
Prior to the snap, false start. Offense, number 81, 5-yard penalty, remains third down.
That's Reams, Javon Reams, guilty of the infraction.
And one of the things that Bethune-Cookman, you know, surprisingly able to do. They were a team that for decades just ran the option, option spread attack. You know, then they had to convert to a spread offense when offensive coordinator Mark Orlando took over with Brian Jenkins as the head coach. And, you know, third and plus 10 is not their strength. You know, they can still get the hard yards needed to run. But how committed are they to a true passing game?
Well, let's see what happens here on this third and long. And here's Isidore Jackson, and Pegues is right there to hit him first and bring him down. So no gain on the play. Back to the line of scrimmage, and that's about it. And to bring up a fourth down punting situation.
Yeah, coming from your left side there, he's going to beat his man with a hard move to the inside. Misses the tackle, but doesn't give up. You see him get back up off the turf and finish off the tackle. Brandon Pegues, the junior from Greensboro, North Carolina. I think he's come to play today.
He certainly has. So this will be the first punt, we think. The last time they faked it for Bethune today. Here's Corey Kowalski. He's averaging 36 yards a punt. And here's Isaiah Thomas brought down right away before he could get anything going. Don't forget, join ESPN in support of our troops, Wounded Warriors, and their families. All you have to do is donate $10 by texting USO to 27722 or go to www.uso.org. 2:54 remaining first quarter. Hampton University with a great field position right now with the ball on the Bethune-Cookman side of midfield at the 48-yard line. best starting position for them today. Let's see if they can do something with this and capitalize on it. Isaiah Thomas in motion, and he has the ball on the end of the round, and he has good yardage and stumbles forward, but does pick up enough for the first down to the 36-yard line.
Yeah, so sticking with the game plan of trying to get the ball to their playmaker, and that's Isaiah Thomas. This is just a good old-fashioned end of round, allowing Thomas to get to the perimeter and pick up the first down.
That's the second time we've seen him run today, so he's run the ball as from its receiver spot about 20 times this season. This time, going to the right side is Chisholm, and look at him pick up yards, and he's down inside the 25 to about the 24-yard line.
And right now, the offensive line for Hampton, particularly on the right side, led by Trey Folks at guard and the senior leadership of Michael Ola, are just pushing around the Bethune-Cookman defensive line. And if you're going to beat Bethune, that's what you got to do. I mean, the one place where they're small is on the defensive line. They've got linebackers that are active, but they have a small defensive line.
One of the things that's been a concern of Hampton University this year is how banged up their offensive line has been. They lost one of their key people early on in the season against Norfolk State, Rafael Vasquez.
Yep.
Then they had to put a young man named McNichols over there who came from the receiver's position, and they put him at the tackle spot. And he's done a pretty good job for him, number 76.
Yeah, I mean, it's rare you go through a college football season, you know, without injuries. And the teams that tend to do well year in and year out are the ones that have the depth or the athletes to replace players when they go down. And I think Coach Rose has done a good job of, you know, having to makeshift offensive line, but not using that as an excuse. When the line went down and the offense struggled, it was time for the defense to step up, and they managed to do that.
And that's what he said yesterday. He's more concerned about not being healthy than Bethune-Cookman's defense. And here's Bynes on a second down and four, and the handoff goes around the right side. Bynes decides to keep it this time, and it looks like he may have enough for the first down. It's going to be close.
Yeah, and what a luxury it is if you're the Hampton Pirates to have Herbert Bynes, your backup quarterback, who was your starting quarterback for two seasons up until this year. And you see Bynes just made a quick decision. You know, that's a senior decision. Make a quick decision. Don't jeopardize it with the pitch. If I've got enough room to pick up the first down, do it. We don't need the home run. So you're looking at David Legree on the sideline. He's their starting quarterback. But he's been banged up and injured.
So this time. Go ahead.
So Herbert Bynes, who was the starter for the previous two seasons, is coming back to start right now. I mean, you talk about having depth. You want depth on your team, but having depth at the quarterback position is always a positive thing.
Hampton right now with 77 yards rushing. That was McLeod, that last carry. You're talking about Bynes, you know, he has Hampton University's single-season completion record with 199, and he also had 2,713 yards 2 years ago back in 2008. He split time at that position last year, but 2 years ago, he was the man.
Yeah, I mean, he had a record-setting quarterback as your backup.
He was the Tebow of Hampton. And there it is, almost a bad play that time. This time, again, Isaiah Thomas coming around the near side on the carry, and he picks up about 4 or 5 yards. They'll make it about 4 yards.
The high snap right here, disrupting the timing, and when that happens, all you want to do is just get it in the guy's hands right away and let him run with it. One thing that happened is being true to form on. We asked them what was the game plan. And you guys are going to be explosive, come out, get to a shootout. They said, no way. We're going to be very methodical. It's been a methodical first quarter.
And with the wind blowing, the game kind of favors this Hampton University running game. No score. We've played 15 minutes of football so far. Second quarter when we come back.
You know I ball. Ready for the excitement? The 2011 MEAC basketball tournament, taking it to the next level.
You're watching ESPNU College Football Primetime, presented by McDonald's. Charlie Neal along with Jay Walker here in Hampton, Virginia, on the Hampton River, where it is third down and 7 for Hampton University. Ball at the 10-yard line of Bethune. And one of the things you got to remember, Bethune has never trailed in a ball game this year.
Their second charge timeout of the half.
So Hampton calls a timeout.
something they didn't like when they got to the line of scrimmage, but they're in position to do something that no other team has done this season, and that is to take the lead over Bethune-Cookman.
Yeah, I mean, that's something. That's the key, you know. They were asking, they said, well, we think we can beat them. You know, we think if we hit the quarterback, we may fold a little bit. And if we get out on them early, we may be able to, you know, see if they can catch somebody from behind. But your defense done a great job holding them scoreless, but they have not capitalized. So that's a tough part that's got to be disappointing if you're the Pirate offensive squad right now. But they are driving.
All right, well, Tuesday night, you can catch ESPNU's All Access Training Days with the Duke Blue Devils and get a behind-the-scenes look at Mike Krzyzewski's practices, team meetings, facilities, and the lives of the coaches and players on and off the court, with Kyle Singler returning in a whole new crop of young talent and defending champs. Look poised for another deep run. Here it is, third down and seven. Hampton University binds fakes, rolls around to the right side, being chased. And tosses it. That may be intentional grounding. No. Let's see. The referee ready to throw the flag, and he's hurt.
Wow.
He is hurt. Bynes is hurt. He's writhing in pain down there.
Yeah, I mean, let's see. Was this going forward like a pass? Like it was an underhand pass?
It wasn't a fumble. He did intentionally let it go.
Yeah. Oh, he just took a bad step there.
Yeah. With the right, looked like the right ankle. Or right
looks
leg,
like
or the left.
Left knee.
Left knee.
Buckle.
Now remember,
David.
So it is going to be intentional grounding because there was not a receiver in the area and the ball never reached the line of scrimmage. So they'll lose, loss down. That'll be bring up fourth down. And while they tend to Mr. Bynes will step aside. No score here in the second quarter.
Rated M for mature. Your car knows.
One, two, ready, and.
ESPNU takes a behind-the-scenes look into the demanding life of being an HBCU band member.
Want it all right now.
See the dedication, heart, and discipline that goes into every note and every step, and the life lessons learned along the way as the Marching Wildcats of Bethune-Cookman and the Marching 100 of Florida A&M prepare to battle in the fifth quarter. ESPNU The Battle, Thursday at 6:30 Eastern.
Well, you look at the Hampton specialists, the long snappers, Vincent Harper, Isaiah Thomas is the holder, and Hernandez is one of five in field goals this year's longest. 36 came against South Carolina State. He has missed also a 45-yarder against A&T. That was his longest attempt, and a 37-yarder against A&T. Let's see if this one is good. Yes! So for the first time this year, Hampton has taken a lead over Bethune-Cookman, and I say the first time this year because Bethune has never trailed a team in a game this season.
Yeah, unfortunately, they're settling for 3 points. I'm sure they would say that, but they take points at a premium so far in this contest.
So Hernandez with only his second field goal of the year, but it put points on the board for the Hampton Pirates in light of the fact that the quarterback goes down on the previous play, and we're going to see how that's going to affect this Hampton offense.
Yeah, I mean, I think if you take a look at Herbert Bynes, you know, there, you know, he was starting because David Legree was injured and banged up, and we saw David Legree. This is the first time David Legree has been dressed all week long, so his effectiveness will be questioned. He's battling with a leg injury, so they've got the lead. That's good news for the Pirates, but the bad news is how many more points will they be able to score?
It's going to be interesting to see. Don't forget Tuesday, see ESPNU's latest college football show. The Experts is host Lowell Galindo. And the Experts provide unfiltered conversation about the hot topics in college football. It's called The Experts on ESPNU Tuesday at 1 Eastern. And in case you missed it, comes back your way at 7 o'clock. So a penalty marker will be thrown against Hampton as the ball goes out of bounds on the far sideline.
See, you can't do that. That's a freshman mistake. You just made a field goal. You're the hero. Everybody's excited about you. And then you kick the ball out of bounds facing the most explosive offense in the MEAC Conference.
16 kicking team. Ball will be placed at the 40-yard line.
So the ball moves out to the 40-yard line, and there you see the kicker, Rodrigo Hernandez, a freshman out of Miami, Florida. So he's working against some of his hometown teammates and home state teammates. So, again, Bethune-Cookman with the first or third, make that the fourth offensive possession for them. Their best start so far. They did get down to the Hampton 20 where they missed on a 33-yard field goal. Screen back to the near side.
Oh, nice.
That's
done.
Murphy. The tight end, and Jordan Murphy gets it all the way across midfield down to the 45-yard line of Hampton University. That's only his fourth catch this year.
Yeah, but take a look at number 73, the left guard, Brandon Gould for Bethune-Cookman. He goes out there, looks for somebody, hit, wham! Got him low. Really thought Murphy would have turned on the Jets. He could have kept running for another 20 yards, but well-executed play by the Wildcats.
They move the ball down to the 44 of Hampton University. This time, Andros Bell, a very hard runner, and he picks up about 5 yards down to the 39, making the 38-yard line of Hampton University. Goes Andros Bell, a redshirt senior from Palm Bay, Florida.
Now look at this. We know they want to hit the quarterback. He doesn't even have the ball. And watch him have to avoid the defensive end trying to make a tackle on him. So the Hampton game plan is in effect. They're going to try and hit Johnson every opportunity they get.
The one thing they're going to have to be careful, they don't get a penalty for an unnecessary roughness, as you see the quickness of Matt Johnson as he takes it all the way down inside the 20. Yard line to about the 18-yard line before James Butts, the free safety, made the stop.
I think that was a case where you had a Pirate defense looking for a read option. They said, well, we're not going to read anything. We'll just call a quarterback draw where we know he's going to run, get him a lead blocker out there, and you see the athleticism of Johnson. Once he gets in trouble, he will head to the sideline to protect his body.
This time, Andros Bell again on the carry, and I'll tell you, he was really hit. And Kendrick Ellis was right there. One to stop the lead, the charge defensively for the Hampton Pirates.
Well, what a benefit that it is to have an active defensive lineman like Kendrick Ellis, who's just that size and can just be a run stopper in the middle. If you know you can't run to the middle, then you make an offense one dimensional. They got to run to the perimeter.
One of the things Brian Jenkins said to me yesterday, he said, my concern with this game is the atmosphere. And I'll tell you, it's great atmosphere here today with homecoming. Here's Matt Johnson. He takes off and runs. Down inside the 10 to the 5, maybe at the 4, first and goal for the Bethune-Cookman Wildcats. He looked to the right, nothing there, and reversed the field and picked up yardage.
I mean, this is what you call pocket presence. Doesn't panic, looks, not there, where do I go? You know, and you can tell the good runners, the ones with pocket presence, they make it look easy. You know, he's not running scared, he's running with the purpose. Nice, smooth, good body control.
Third time this year that they're ranked second in the conference in red zone offense. They normally do something constructive when they get this close to the end zone, and trying to go off the left side is Andros Bell, and he doesn't get much back to the original line of scrimmage, and maybe that's it. Maybe a yard on the play.
Once again, running and Rangan Beast doing a good job of manning the fourth there. Really good looking defensive end slash linebacker for Hampton.
There you see 50 possessions, 39 touchdowns, and a field goal when they are in the red zone. And that's pretty good percentage. And here's a pass, a little fade, and it's incomplete. Trying to get in the end zone. And it could have been a little offensive pass interference there. He was trying to push the defensive man down as Eddie Poole went up for it. He was one of those kids that was at Rutgers with Coach Brian Jenkins last year. He came along with him. He didn't have to sit out because he was going from an FBS school to an FCS school, so he was able to play right away. This is Reams in motion. This is the third down. Here's the quarterback trying to get to the end zone. Cuts back, will not get there. So they're going to probably have to settle for a field goal. Let's see. They may go for it on fourth down. They have been known to do that.
Yeah, and I think it's going to become a matter of how close to get to the end zone. So they want to know as well. And you see him make a decision. Let me make one guy miss, cut up field, and get it to the 2 or 3 yard line. When you got an offense that's trying to go out and win a championship, you get down in the red zone inside your opponent's less than 5 yard line, I think you go for it too, especially when you're on the road.
43% on fourth downs this year. They've already missed on one this year when they tried a fake punt. And the punter ran with it. Here it is, fourth down. Here's the quarterback under pressure. Will not get it. Sacked. in the backfield. Big number 50 defensively, 52, Carson Bird came in there and said, no way, Jose.
Yeah, you knew they got him in trouble. That was a big stop by the Pirate defense. Huge stop there. Matt Johnson got himself in trouble. All of his wide receivers are to the right side of your screen. He tries to scramble to the left side. That's how you knew he was in trouble. There was nobody to throw it to. He recognized it right away. And Carson Bird there with the big stop for the Pirates.
So they get the ball. That is leading 3-0 Hampton University at their own 12-yard line. Here's a team that's been averaging over 44 points a game. They have never trailed in a ball game. All of those things are going against Bethune right now. As David LeGree has come into the lineup, let's see how effective he can be. As Jay said earlier, he has not practiced all week. He's got knee problems, and he said he'll go if he has to. That's what he told me yesterday, but they're going to let him hand off. They're not going to get him in a whole lot of trouble, and they keep it on the ground with Chisholm.
Yeah, you know, they're going to go to the ground game. And I mean, LeGree's a guy very gifted athletically, 6'4", goes about 230 pounds, very mobile. But, you know, part of the problem was he would try and create too much offense. He would run when it's time to step out of bounds, and eventually it caught up to him during the year. So you mentioned a knee problem, also battling an ankle injury, so he has severely limited mobility. But you get a game like this, you're hoping that adrenaline will carry you through.
One of the things that Bynes was able to do, he stayed in the pocket a little more than and here we got a ball picked up after a fumble and into the end zone. Let's see if it can be returned for a touchdown. Let's see what's going on.
They called him down.
They called him down. Runner down.
I'm pretty sure that they did. I know I heard a whistle blow, but you know, the bigger concern here is after that play action pass.
Did you see
the run?
Did you see LeGree?
Yeah, he's
and he didn't get hit. He didn't get hit. He was barely getting over to the sideline. Let's see what the officials say.
We have a first whistle. The player did immediately recover by Bethune Cookman. It will be first and goal from
the inadvertent whistle, they say, and it's a fumble recovered by Bethune Cookman. So the first turnover of the ball game.
You see that, right, that ball clearly comes out. You see that Ryan Lewis was there around the football to make that, but because of the change in college football now, in years past, keep in mind, you see LeGree, watch LeGree after this. He's going to pull up. He's hurting. But in years past in college football, had that inadvertent whistle, you know, gone off, the play would have been
right there. Yeah.
Been right there, and then, you know, Hampton would have had an opportunity to keep the football because it was blown because the official thought that he was down. But now they're saying, hey, no. The whistle did go off, but it was a fumble. So Bethune-Cookman is rewarded for playing the good defense. So I think that's a positive change they've made to the college football rule book.
I think it was Ryan Lewis who was the man number 15 who picked up that fumble.
Yes.
And brought it back. He didn't give him the touchdown, but the ball is placed at the 8-yard line. First down and 10 to make it first and goal. And here is Isidore Jackson trying to go off the left side with nothing doing.
Kobe Finner coming up from that outside linebacker position with the outside contain. And give credit to this Pirate defense. I mean, they've really come here and really show that they are not intimidated by this Bethune-Cookman offense.
Isidore Jackson, the lone setback in the backfield with the quarterback, Matt Johnson. Johnson gives to Jackson again, and Jackson is hit immediately. And who hit him? Kendrick Ellis.
If you're going to run the ball in the middle, yeah, I'm pretty sure Kendrick Ellis is going to be the guy that's going to hit you. Let's take a look what he does. They've got the double team on. He splits the two of them, mm-hmm. and then makes a tackle. You know, just watching him in pregame, he's a big man, Charles. I mean, he's got NFL body all over.
Well, you know, when scouts come in, normally, originally, they send the 15th scout. But right now, the director of scouting has been coming in to the Hampton backfield to see what's going on, the defensive side, to look at Kendrick Ellis.
Yeah, he's definitely an impressive talent. You see the Pirate defense time and time again when the challenges are made, they stepped up to keep the Wildcats out of the offense, and some offensive frustration starting to set in. But you take a look at Ellis. I mean, he's leading tackler in the MEAC conference from the nose tackle position.
Right.
I mean, the leading tackle is normally always going to be a linebacker or a strong safety.
Kowalski, who still hasn't kicked the field goal. This is 23 yards, and this one is good. So he has finally hit his first field goal of the season. 9:31, the time remaining. First half, second quarter, all tied at 3 here in Hampton.
Hi, I'm Reese.
ESPNU College Football Primetime is brought to you by the Capital One Cup. To learn more, go to CapitalOneCup.com. Charlie Neal, Jay Walker in Armstrong Stadium on the campus of Hampton University. Bethune Cookman's band on hand for homecoming 2010. All tied at 3 here in the second quarter. As Corey Kowalski, the sophomore from Rockland, just hit a 23-yard field goal to put Bethune Cookman on the board. They had not trailed any team all season long until this game when Hampton went up 3-0 on a field goal by Hernandez. So now Hampton University ready to receive this kickoff. Isaiah Thomas is the deep man. It'll come to one of the up men. And let's look at our Facebook question. We want you to log on to facebook.com/ESPNU and become a fan. And here's what we want to know. And Jay, you might want to chime in on this after we get our fans' opinion. Should there be an HBCU national championship game? And we'll find out. I don't want to hear it now.
Well, no, I just want to say before they answer, they need to know some of the facts.
Okay.
We're going to turn to why there is not currently a national championship game. What are some of the rules? Like in postseason, the winner of the MEAC conference currently gets an automatic bid to the postseason play. The winner of the SWAC conference plays in the SWAC championship game, so they don't go to the postseason FCS playoffs. SIAC and CIAA, you know, they compete in the Division II playoffs.
Correct. Here's new running back, and this is Steve Robinson on the carry. You look at the Sheridan poll. You can see Grambling from the SWAC is on top. The Bill Cookman in this game here from the MEAC. Albany State from the SIAC, a Division II school. They have a big game today, and they're playing Fort Valley, and that is down in Columbus, Georgia, in the Fountain City Classic. So that's going to be very interesting. That could decide the SIAC championship.
So with all that being said, we know the Black College National Championship to be eligible. You can be Division I.
Or two.
Or two. And AIA schools can be in four as well. So
Isaiah Thomas on the pass and now flag. We may have a face mask on the far sideline on the reception from the Legree.
Personal foul. Face mask. Number 27 of the defense. 10-yard penalty added to the end of the run.
Daniel
automatic
Rhodes.
First down.
Number 27, the man guilty. There it is.
Yeah, got it. That's when it gets dangerous.
Not only does he have it, he just doesn't let go, does he?
Right, he wasn't going to let go. And, you know, those are some things we talked about, the defensive discipline they're going to need to have in this contest. Given the offense, it's not going to try and move the ball vertically down the field. Then what you have to do is make sure you just play sound defense.
This Hampton University team is doing everything that they expected them to do today. Here's a team that was averaging over 44 points a game, scored 60 points 3 times this year, and 67 in their last outing against North Carolina A&T. And Hampton University is handling it pretty good. Steve Robinson on the carry, and Steve Robinson, who just came in off the bench, takes it down inside the 35 to the 33.
Yeah, you know, that's not a good sign right there for
Bynes.
For Bynes right there, they've got the air cast on them right there. Tough going on, you know, senior getting opportunities to play again and to start for your homecoming and go out early in the contest. Tough break.
This time is Chisholm on the carry for the first down for Hampton University. So the game plan is working for Fred Kice and Donovan Rose and that offense and what they wanted to do.
You know, they're methodical. You know, they just want to move the ball sideline to sideline, get the ball to playmakers in some space, and pick up 3 or 4 yards at a time to move the ball slow down the field. They've had some success. I mean, they've been across the 40-yard line several times in this contest.
One of the things they have kept Bynes out of trouble. And here they go, handoff again. This time, Isaiah Thomas to the near side, cuts inside, and finally he's upended before he could get ahead of steam going by Ozzie Slater, number 21.
Yeah, look at the excitement there. You know, they brought the safety blitz. They said, well, you're not going to go the ball vertically downfield. We'll shoot the gap and try and get somebody there to get you. You see Isaiah Thomas did a good job of just avoiding the contact. And look at the flip. Whoa!
So it'll bring second down and three after the 7-yard run by Zeke. Isaiah Thomas, no relation to the...
Is that why you called him Zeke? Zeke Junior. Isaiah Thomas?
Yeah.
The legendary Hall of Fame point guard from the Pistons.
Yeah. Coaching basketball in Florida right now. And a flag goes down for a false start against the Pirates.
Prior to the snap, false start. Offense, number five.
We just got word that unofficially, it's a torn ACL left leg of Herbert Vines, and we'll get more at halftime. So that's not good news, especially with a banged up LeGree. But like I said, so far they've protected him pretty good. That offensive line has done a good job, and the type of plays they've been running have kept the pressure off of their cobbled quarterback. Blitz is shown by Bethune, and they keep the ball on the ground. Chisholm goes straight ahead, and Chisholm gets it down to about the 20-yard line.
Yeah, I mean, this has been a good job by the offensive line for Hampton University, you know, recognizing that we're going to run the football, and I think Bethune Cookman has made some adjustments as well. And they started to crowd the line of scrimmage, as you see emotions and tempers flare there. But, you know, when you got one team that knows you want to run the ball, that's a pretty good job by offensive line. They're able to run the ball in spite of them crowding the line of scrimmage, bringing an extra defender in to stop the run. You know, I'm thinking here, third and one, they think we're just going to run the ball. Why not take a deep shot here? Go towards the end zone. Play action.
Well, they're doing a good job of blocking those people coming in to on the blitz. I'll tell you, you watched one of the players up in, one of the defensive players coming in from Bethune-Cookman, actually the Sandilands who got upended there, are coming in on the blitz from his linebacker spot. So that bring up a fourth down and one. Now they're going to go for it on this fourth and one situation. So far this year, they're 2 of 8 in fourth down conversions. Coming into the game, LeGree. Does he carry it?
He can quarterback, so he can get the yard. There's a bubble there.
No, he's going to hand off. And look at Steve Robinson gets the first down with plenty to spare to the 15.
Steve Robinson.
Good job by the offensive line. Steve Robinson, their power back. He doesn't move left to right too well. He goes north-south very well. Big hole there. Good job by the right side of that offensive line with Jamal Lewis and Scott McNichols bulldozing their defenders.
So Javaris Brown goes to the far side, as does Darius McCain. Lone setback is Chisholm, the freshman, three-time rookie of the year, or rookie of the week, I should say, this year. And it goes to the freshman. He tries to cut it back, and nothing doing. The Sandlin was right there to make the stop defensively.
I think if you're Hampton, although the Hampton faithful may be getting a little bit uneasy, keep in mind during that running play there, I mean, the clock continues to tick. So, you know, you got 4 minutes to go in the half. You can take this clock down to 2 minutes going to halftime.
And you see why we call this a championship game? Look at the standings. And Bethune-Cookman is getting a lot of support from South Carolina State today. They're the ones that's hoping that this team wins. And because when you look at the playoffs, the FCS playoffs, you know, it's a chance that the NEAC can get two teams in this year. Here's a pitch to the left side. Here's Chisholm cutting it back. Chisholm still on his feet, and Chisholm down inside the 10 to about the 9-yard line. That was on a second and 12 play. And he gets it down to about the 9, a gain of...
You're committed to running the football. When it's second and 12 and you call toss right sweep, toss left sweep. They are committed to running the football, letting the clock look. The quarterback's there. Mm-hmm. He's looking at the 25-second clock right there in front of him, taking his time.
Letting it run.
They
down.
Are taking the air out of the football. It's got to be frustrating for the Wildcats.
They have a great game plan so far, Jay. Here's Steve Robinson, the lone setback, and he has the handoff, turns the corner, gets away from one man, he's into the end zone. Touchdown. Steve Robinson with the touchdown run, his third of the year from 8 yards out.
Nice and methodical, but great seal block there by Michael Ola, again, number 62. Got him on the inside, held him in there. Take a look at the body. Look at 62. You won't see him there, but David's got a nice little celebration jog right there. Look at that. See, when you run like that, when you come over to the sideline, you know what the coach says? Hey, I thought you were hurt.
Sometimes you forget the pain. Oh, I was supposed to be hurt.
Yeah.
But that touchdown made me feel good, I'll tell you.
Adrenaline is the best medicine in the world.
Here's the point after attempt by Hernandez. It's up. It's good. And it's a 10-3 ball game with 3:02 to go. All the way down the field for the Pirates of Hampton University from their own 36. They convert with an 8-yard run. .302 remaining, second quarter, 10-3 the score. There you see Steve Robinson just picked up his third touchdown of the year on an 8-yard run to give his team a little breathing room, a 7-point lead. That's the senior from Buford, Georgia, Georgia Military Academy. He was there back in 2008, which he ran for 20 touchdowns and over 1,100 yards. Here's the kick, returned by Courtney Keith. Inside the 5-yard line, and he runs into a brick wall from Hampton University, Robert McIntosh, number 37. Let's look at that touchdown run, though, by Steve Robinson once again.
Yeah, it all starts with the right tackle, Michael Ola, number 62. You see him in your spot shadow. Watch this reach block to go and turn this Bethune Cookman defensive end inside out. Once he gets him on the inside, pins him, plenty of room for Steve Robinson to run to play touch to give the Pirates the lead.
And Bethune finding themselves in a position they haven't been in all season. Second time today they have trailed in this ball game.
Yeah, but now it's a little different. This time they trail by a touchdown and not just a field goal.
And here's the quarterback, can't get away from Pegues. He made him turn it inside, and Matt Johnson goes down.
Something we talked about earlier, the Hampton defense has to be careful. We know they want to hit the quarterback, and you and I were talking off camera about the fact that they're starting to get borderline overly aggressive, mm-hmm. and the officials could easily throw a penalty marker on them for unnecessary roughness. So they need to control their enthusiasm.
Yeah, you see the total yards for Bethune, just 88, 217 for the Pirates. And here's Matt Johnson. He lets it go, and it's complete. But what a hit taken by Pat Brown, another one of those young men who came from Rutgers with Coach Brian Jenkins, and the man who made the hit was Ricardo Silva. I'll tell you, he can hit.
Oh, man, he follows through. I mean, Silva's a guy that got 4 interceptions on the year, but watch him follow through on this. 6 feet, 2 inches tall, 210 pounds, and lowers his shoulder.
Third down and 2. And here's Isidore Jackson trying to get to the first down marker, and it's going to be very close. He had to get to the 30-yard line. And they may have to measure. No, they... I think Hampton called a timeout. They are saying it is a first down. A minute 56 is the time remaining. Or maybe Hampton didn't call a timeout. I was looking at Coach Donovan Rose out there. He was talking to the line judge. So to bring up a first and 10, the ball at the 30-yard line. Under 2 minutes to go, the clock running, and still people running off the field for the Pirates of Hampton. This one is supposed to be a screen pass that falls incomplete. Poole just couldn't pull it in.
I think the tactics by the Pirate offense have really paid off in helping the defense. I mean, you know Bethune-Cookman, they're saying, hey, we're Bethune-Cookman. We're not going to have 3 points going in at halftime. And they just have been able to find no offensive rhythm whatsoever after the first two possessions. You know, having the three and out, and then going on the sidelines and sitting there in the cold wind. They just look like a Florida team playing in cold conditions that they're not used to.
It is second down and 10, and as you said, Jay, this Hampton team has been a second-half team in terms of scoring, and this pass this time is caught by Poole on the far sideline. And he's going to be still short of a first down, but in the first half, Hampton has been outscored 92-42 this year by 50 points. In the second half, they've outscored their opponents, or they scored 99 of their 141 points in the second half. So they've been a second half team, but they had to be a first half team today, didn't they?
Yes, good news for the Pirates here at homecoming. The fact that they're going to halftime with the lead, your team typically gets better during the second half of the game. But you know, asterisk, don't want to ruin the homecoming party here. They still got some questions before that.
Oh, no question. No
I think that's going to come to surface in the second half.
So that third down and 3 pass goes incomplete. So that'll bring on a punting.
And they've got a great, you know, they got a great homecoming atmosphere.
Oh, they do.
I mean, this is my first Hampton homecoming, and they made it clear by me being a Howard guy, I really wasn't welcome. But they've got some, they've got some good sights and atmosphere.
What do you mean that you aren't welcome? That punt by Cole Kowalski. It'll be Hampton's ball Tuesday night. Kyle Singler returning and a whole new crop of young talent, defending champs, look poised for another deep run. All access training days with Duke Blue Devils on ESPNU Tuesday night at 9 Eastern. There's your look at the preseason top five poll, Duke, Virginia Tech. I mean, it's going to be pretty good.
It is. Coach K, look at that. That's how you got here, Charlie. I see you got your limousine. But Coach K, having a good recruit class. Just got the number five point guard from Oak Hill, Quinn Cook. Just committed to Duke this week, so got to be feeling good about himself.
There's a lateral. Intercepted. That pass was intended. And we got a flag, and we got a man down for Bethune Cookman. Chris Perry is the man that's down. For Bethune.
This is the poor decision. I mean, double pass here.
This is Steve Robinson throwing the ball.
Yeah, and he was just throwing it to nobody. I mean, you got two white jerseys there. Good job.
McCain.
Good job by McCain. And just go ahead. And, are they going to call that helmet to helmet? Did he launch it to the passer?
They threw the flag. They picked up the flag. Whatever the flag was, and waved it off.
Well, you got two teams that are stressing being tough and being physical. You know, unfortunately, there are going to be some injuries in the game. I mean, this is a very physical football game being played before us. And we're starting to see bodies out. It seems like almost every other play, somebody's going down with some type of injury.
Well, it's going to be very interesting to see what Bethune can do as Bethune player goes off the field. Chris Perry under his own power. You talk about Hampton's defense, passing efficiency defense, where they rank fifth, total ninth, pass defense 11th, and scoring defense 13th. So, you know, they're not shabby at all.
No, it's leading me to believe that a good defense can beat a good offense. Being a former offensive player, I like to think the offense can win.
Here's Matt Johnson. Little dump off pass on the near side, and Johnson has nowhere to run and nowhere to go with this ball after he made the reception. He's talking trash to the sideline, but I'll tell you, he needs to talk trash upfield.
They need to, you know, and it's growing. I mean, you notice that every time that Hampton comes up to make a tackle, the hits are getting harder and harder, and the stadium's starting to get involved, and I think the crowd came in expecting a shootout. They're starting to get interested in this exciting physical football game we've got.
Now, after the fumble before, Bethune was able to put 3 points on the board. Now let's see if they can do anything after intercepting this pass as Tony Wilson, the freshman out of Daytona Beach, Florida, Mainland High, comes up with the reception.
Well, this is just something to get the drive going, the crossing route right here. Wilson does a good job of a good stiff arm, but once again, it being made on the sideline. Pirate defense came to put some hits and body marks on the Wildcat offense.
Third and we'll call it four. Matt Johnson, he's going to take off and run, and he will not get anywhere because number 11 was there defensively for Hampton. That's Jacob Fenner.
Yeah, Jacoby Fenner doing a good job of just filling the hole, playing the outside linebacker. He's spying him. He's got him in the sights the whole time, and good hit put on the legs of Matt Johnson.
Clock still running with 43 seconds to go. Here's Fenner. Jacoby Fenner, senior from Hampton, Virginia, went to Hampton High right here. Going to let this clock run down.
Hampton High's got a pretty good football program.
Yes, they do.
Only problem, they happen to be in the same geographic region as Phoebus High, number four ranked team in the country.
Well, they're going to run this play clock down. They're just going to let it run out and take the penalty, I guess. Or call a timeout. That's Bethune's first time out. They have two left. I guess they're going to talk about what's going on. There's been a lot of activities part of homecoming 2010.
Is that a horse?
Yes, it is. And a buggy. That's your chariot out of here.
Yeah, I rode in that. You brought the limousine, and I ride home in the horse and buggy. But I mean, I'm sitting here thinking, pirates ride on ships. They don't ride on horses and buggies. I saw the horse and thought, I lost my location where I was.
This is a class act down here at Hampton University, and I'll tell you, they've got it all going on for them today on homecoming 2010.
I will tell you this, they're going to be in for a treat. I'm pretty sure this crowd hasn't seen the Bethune Cookman band too often.
Not here.
There's a little difference in bands in the MEAC when you talk about north and south. You know, if you broke it down to like the north and south region, south region's got the north beat pretty good.
That's 24-karat gold getting ready. Meanwhile, Kowalski punts it straight up in the air. Boy, let me look at this.
They lose
yards on that. Unfortunately, for Hampton, it's only 6 seconds left on the clock.
Well, now
that's the only saving grace for them.
Yeah, but there's nothing unfortunate about that for Hampton, because now you can take a chance by throwing a Hail Mary in the end zone.
You have to.
You know, I don't know if you've got enough time to get a quick 5-yard pass pattern, but I think you take a shot at the end zone and maybe put one up for grabs and see if a wide receiver can come down with it.
Well, they get the ball at the 40-yard line, inside the 40, at the 39, with 6.5 seconds to go on the clock. As you look at Donovan Rose, his team doing something nobody else has been able to do this year, and that's take a lead over this Bethune-Cookman squad. The Wildcats with that speed offense, speedway offense that they've made so prevalent throughout this 8-0 season.
Now, one thing to be careful about, you see Coach Jenkins, his reaction says it all. You know, as a former quarterback, people don't realize on a Hail Mary pass,
nine times out of ten,
a quarterback gets hit. Because you've got to hold that ball for a while to allow your wide receivers to run down the field.
Mm-hmm.
And they've got a quarterback that can't move out the pocket to buy some extra time. So just keep an eye on Herbert Bynes here and see.
Well, maybe that's why they had Steve Robinson throw the last pass. You see what happened. It was intercepted.
Yep. You got to move to buy a little time for the wide receivers to get down the field if they are going to attempt the Hail Mary.
Well, that's what they're doing.
See, you got to move.
And he's in trouble, and he's brought down.
Yeah.
And that should be the last play of the half. Now, hopefully he can get off the field without being injured, because he has been banged up. So Hampton gets the ball to start the second half. Remember, they won the opening toss, or the toss of the coin, and they deferred. Second half coming up. We're at halftime, 10-3, Hampton.
Watch and see. We gon' get a victory. It's game.
So, 1, 2, ready, and.
ESPNU takes a behind-the-scenes look into the demanding life of being an HBCU band member.
Want it all right now.
See the dedication, heart, and discipline that goes into every note and every step, and the life lessons learned along the way as the Marching Wildcats of Bethune-Cookman and the Marching 100 of Florida A&M prepare to battle in the fifth quarter. ESPNU The Battle, Thursday at 6:30 Eastern.
ESPNU College Football Primetime presented by McDonald's. We're getting ready to start the second half here. Homecoming 2010 in Hampton, Virginia, where the Pirates have a surprising 10-3 lead over the Wildcats of Bethune, I was going to say. And defense has been the order of the day here. Hampton, the number 9 team nationwide defensively against the number 2 team offensively.
Yeah, they started off getting physical. Brandon Pegues, good second effort here to make the tackle. And then, of course, they've got everybody's All-American. Kendrick Ellis in the middle, stopping the run penetration. Bethune-Cookman then on a crucial play, 4th and 3. It was Carson Byrd making the sack with Matt Johnson and Keith. Wildcats at the end zone in the first half.
And Hampton gets the ball to start the second half right now. And bringing it back up the field for the Pirates of Hampton. A good return for Hampton University by Javaris Brown. As we look at some first half stats, and the thing that stands out the most is the rushing yards for Bethune. Only 43 yards for Bethune, 190 for Hampton. And out of those 190 yards for Hampton, 126 goes to the freshman Chisholm.
Yeah, I mean, that's crucial. But also the fact that Hampton's turned the football over 2 times, and yet Bethune-Cookman has not been able to capitalize and put a touchdown on the board.
Yeah, that is very big. We'll see how that stands up here. So at the 42-yard line, after a good return, we'll see David LeGree back in there. He's been hobbled, had to come in because Herbert Bynes went down with a knee injury in the first half.
Come on, a big Pirate round of applause for our former Miss Hampton.
This time,
fumble.
A fumble, and it's picked up. And bringing it back for Bethune defensively is Ozzie Slater, and he's in the end zone. But let's see if this holds up. Or was that Daniel Rhodes, 27, as opposed to 21? Daniel Rhodes picks it up. So Rhodes returns the fumble, and that's the third turnover of the ball game for Hampton University.
Yeah, we just talked about how surprising it was the fact that
result of the
Hampton
play,
had turned the ball over twice.
After the play.
But still, Bethune didn't capitalize on it. So take a look at the replay here. Just a quarterback, running back exchange. He stepped out of bounds. They didn't catch that.
And no replay at the FCS level. So, again, if not. Now, see that celebration flag next year. If he does that about the five-yard line, they're going to bring the ball out to the five. So here's the point after for Kowalski. Point is up. The kick is good. And now it is all tied at 10 apiece, 14-41, just that quickly. Bethune's back in it. Let's go to your mid-game report.
Yeah, take a look at our mid-term report. You know, 30 points, first time I've ever given out an F, Charlie. You know, I'm an easy grader, but they only scored 3 points, your number one offense. Stay disciplined on defense. I gave them a C. They had some unnecessary penalties there. For Hampton University, control the clock. They did an outstanding job winning the time of possession. They actually were ball hawk, 17 minutes to only 12 minutes. And the number 13 equals 13 hits. They've already hit him 14 times in the first half alone. You know, I've given them two A's, but the second half starts A. You can still go from an A to an F in my classroom.
And you look at the 10 points that Bethune Cookman has put up on the board. Remember, that's all a result of miscues by Hampton University. Remember, the first one came after a fumble. They got a field goal, and then another fumble is returned for a touchdown. So with the two, now you've got 10 points on the board.
And the thing about it is, you know, both of those fumbles, there's been one common denominator on the fumbles that led to points. And it's been freshman running back Antoine Chisholm for Hampton University. You know, when you're in a game like this, maybe he doesn't understand the magnitude. Maybe he's pressing a little bit too hard, but he's put the ball on the ground two times, and they've made him pay each time.
Here's a short kick again this time. Again, of Tavares Brown on the return. He made a good one. The last time fumble again, and I think Bethune has it. This time, Tavares Brown on the return, and he fumbles it, and is still scrambling over there for the ball. But the officials, I believe, have already decided that it goes to Bethune-Cookman. At least Bethune-Cookman thinks they have it. We'll wait to see the official word from our referee. It is Bethune-Cookman's ball. So another turnover on the ensuing kickoff. 14:36 to go.
Turn, man.
Brown right there. The ball just knocked out.
That's just a good hit. Solid hit. Put on by the Bethune Cookman special teams.
Yeah, that was Preston Cleckley who came up with the hit that caused the fumble. Here's Matt Johnson going upstairs. That should be picked off. Almost. I'll tell you, he was trying to get it to his receiver Reams.
This is a good job by Javon Reams. He loses where the football is, so he goes to play defensive back, and he just runs into Romeo Pullum. Defensive back that was in position to make an interception, so that's a good job of adjusting by Reams. Didn't see the football, but saw the defensive back reacting. He went up to make a play.
So it'll be second and 10, ball at the 48 of Hampton University, keeping it on the ground this time. Running straight ahead is Cookman, and the flag is down on the play.
The late flag that came in there. But you know, one of the things we talked about were all the hits they want to do on Matt Johnson. Watch Matt Johnson. When he gives the ball away, he doesn't have it, they're still going to tackle. So they're getting real close. And that one, on that one there, Johnson went to the ground. And he actually asked the official, are you going to let him keep hitting me like that? And the official kind of gave him that look like you're carrying out a play fake.
Well, the call was against, I believe, still it might have been against Hampton University, which gave them an automatic first down. It had to be a 15-yard personal foul. So let's see what happens now with the ball at the 31 of Hampton University, first down and 10. Matt Johnson, quick drop, throws, has a complete to his tight end, Murphy. His second reception of the day. And a 5-yard gain for a freshman out of Concord, Massachusetts.
That's been a tough one.
There's some defensive numbers. McGee's with 7 tackles, Kendrick Ellis with 6, Finner, and Johnson all in on the stop defensively for Hampton University. Here's Isidore Jackson, and he's got the first down inside the 20 to the 19-yard line. Goes Isidore Jackson. He had 3 touchdowns against the Aggies of A&T a week ago. All came in the first half. They scored on their first 5 possessions against the Aggies, but struggled here today. Here's Jackson. Oh, he was in. He was really hit by big number 74, Jamie Slaughter, the redshirt senior, or freshman rather, from Hazelwood High in St. Louis, Missouri.
Yeah, Slaughter, number 74, right in the middle of your screen. He's going to do a good job of shielding off the blocker and putting the boom. Bethune Cookman running back.
Second down, 2nd and 9. And the pitch to the right side. And down the right side, a good run for Bethune's Courtney Keith, who's a special teams guy. We normally see him on kick returns, and they gave him the pitch that time.
Yeah, we're starting to see a little bit of lack of discipline or frustration by the Pirate offense. Flag was thrown very late in that play for a late hit out of bounds.
After the play, personal foul. Number 2 of the defense, a late hit out of bounds. Half the distance to the goal, results in the first down.
That's James Butts, redshirt junior from Norfolk, Virginia, right down the road at Maury High. He's guilty of the personal foul, late hit out of bounds, and first down and goal now for Bethune Cookman. They have not scored an offensive touchdown today.
All start, offense, number 83.
Murphy, the tight end, with a false start. So the ball is going to be moved outside the 10. It'll still be first and goal, but it'll be marked at about the 11-yard line. Isidore Jackson, again, Bethune has not scored an offensive touchdown today. Fumble, and now Matt Johnson just has the fall on it to keep any more disastrous from happening. Not a good snap from the center, Mateo Curry.
I mean, you know, it wasn't an accurate snap, but that's one he just should have had there. You know, you've got bodies coming at you, you start to see it. And one thing about Matt Johnson, we know, if nothing else, he's been hit by this Pirate defense. And sooner or later, you start to think, hey, if I don't catch this thing cleanly, I know I've got somebody coming to hit me.
First, make that second and goal at the 16. Here they come. Here's a screen. Isidore Jackson has people in front of him. He's at the 5. He's in there. Touchdown. 16-yard screen play to the left side to Isidore Jackson. And Bethune takes the lead and scores their first offensive touchdown of the day.
Yeah, great play call. You know they want to get to the quarterback and hit him. Well, bait him in. Let him come think they're getting a free shot on the quarterback. Instead, just make a screen call and get to an aggressive defensive line. Excellent call by Mark Orlando, the offensive coordinator for Bethune Cookman. This PAT is blocked.
And if they pick it up and run it back, it could be.
It's still live. He's got it.
It is still live. And taking it back for the Hampton Pirates is Robert McIntosh. He'll go in, and that'll give him 2 points.
2 points, and more importantly, it's going to give him a spark of energy.
Let's go.
After seeing Bethune rattle off 13 uncontested points. They get 2 points on special teams.
Boy, I'll tell you, this game has had everything. There you go. There's the touchdown on the screen pass to Isidore Jackson. And then they try to go the extra point. McIntosh picks it up. He takes it the distance. And now it's a 16-12 game.
Mission on ESPN UHD by Comcast.
16-12 as you look at Mr. McIntosh put 2 points on the board. It's a 4-point ball game. And let's take a look at some of the action from halftime. Brought to you by McDonald's. Bringing the flavor, brought to you by McDonald's. Bethune Cookman's band travels all the way from Daytona Beach for homecoming 2010 in Hampton, and what a show they put on.
I mean, they were so good that the Hampton folks stood up and gave them a standing applause, so they did a fantastic job, and more importantly, it looks like they jump-started the Wildcat football team.
Yeah, they jump-started them. Also, the Hampton team not doing too badly either, leading 10-3 at halftime, and then here in the third quarter, Bethune with 13 points. And again, all but that last 6 points came as a result of turnovers by Hampton University. And then McIntosh takes the block punt back the distance, picking it up and puts more points on the board for the Pirates. And it's a 16-12 ball game. And now they're going to get the ball once again, trailing by 4 points as Kowalski has it on the tee, getting ready to kick it off. The last couple times they've just had problems holding on to the football down here. This is Hampton University. They fumbled twice in the third quarter, the last kickoff return. This time it's Isaiah Thomas on the return. Here's Isaiah Thomas down the sideline with a good return all the way across the 40 to about the 45-yard line, make it the 48. The Tuesday, see ESPNU's latest college football show. The Experts, as host Lowell Galindo, and the experts provide unfiltered conversation about the hot topics in college football. It's the Experts on ESPNU Tuesday, 1 Eastern. And in case you can't see the show live, you can catch it on an encore presentation at 7 p.m. You've been on that show. Pretty good.
Oh, they got some interesting topics now. How about that story coming out of Auburn, Alabama about Cam Newton? That's a big one. And Joe Paul trying to get to number 400.
Oh, that's big. I mean, not many people have gotten in that 400 range. You talk about Eddie Robinson from this level at the FCS level. And I mean, that's tall cotton, as they say down south.
Very tall cotton.
First down and 10. Here again is Steve Robinson trying the right side. And maybe a yard for Mr. Robinson here. This drive starts at their own 49. This is Hampton.
Well, I guess, you know, the good thing about having that 2 points you have, you know, not that sense of urgency. You know, you start falling down by a touchdown or more, you start to come up with a sense of urgency. They just don't have all their offensive weapons that they need for Hampton, so that special teams play could turn out to be huge.
This time, Chisholm had 126 yards in the first half. He's dropped for no gain as we look at the standings in the MEAC and see what this is all about. Bethune unbeaten, one of three FCS schools coming into today's play unbeaten, along with Jacksonville State and Appalachian State. And of course, you see the logjam for that number two spot in the MEAC at 4-1 between South Carolina State, Florida A&M, and this Hampton University team. Third down and 9 now for Hampton. Standing in there, boy, he had to let that one go. That was pressure on the quarterback, Legree. And, I mean, he threw that thing. It was like a bullet shot out of his arm.
I mean, just watch him protecting that left ankle. You see it there. He's real ginger on it. Gets it out of there. And then as soon as he throws it, look, he's hop. Sorry, it's the right ankle. That's that plant ankle that you need right there. And, you know, the bad thing about that is the other team sees that. The other defense, they know that you're limping around that badly. So they're gonna, it's like, you know, sharks in water. Once they get that first drop of blood, they come more.
Courtney Keith will let this one go. He will not get a chance. And a great kick that time by Stovall. It goes out of bounds at about the 3-yard line. So they bury Bethune deep with 10:02 left in the third. ESPNU College Football Primetime brought to you by Sports Clips, the ultimate just for guys haircuts experience. Sport Clips. It's good to be a guy. You don't need a clip, does
he? He's definitely one of the more animated. For years, he's been one of the more animated mascots I've seen throughout the country.
I'll tell you, it was a great shot. I don't know if we ever had it, but the mascot sitting down just chilling at halftime. The pirate, here it is, the pirate and the Wildcat. Hey, we're just chilling here. It's homecoming,
come
you know.
Come on, you can't do that.
First and 10, Matt Johnson working deep in his own territory, hands it off, and here is Moment on the carry. Jonathan Moment, back from a sprained knee, just had a son a couple of weeks ago, and coach gave him a couple of days off so he could go visit with the young lady and the young son, and I'll tell you, they're hoping good things for him as he comes back into the lineup. Of course, Isidore Jackson has done a good job in taking up the slack, so he gains 8 yards in the second down and two.
Yeah, he's done a good job, but that was a missed opportunity by the Pirates defense to create a scoring opportunity for the offense. They could have got a good stop and pinned him back deep.
Here's Moment again, and Moment picks up the first down and is across the 25 to the 26.
I'm surprised where they're running the football. Let's take a look at the replay, see if we can find Kendrick Ellis. And what are they doing to combat that? Ah, you put two bodies on them. Easy to find a hole that way.
Open that hole up. So, I could have got through there, right?
Yeah, that's what they did. So I think they made the adjustment that we'll put two bodies on Kendrick Ellis for the rest of the game and try to wear him out.
The Moment again gets the carry. They're gone to the workhorse Moment. Comes in at 220 pounds, a sophomore out of Highland Prep in Orlando.
So watch Kendrick. What does he decide to do? Lower the pad level.
Yeah.
And then trip him up in the backfield. See, that's what has NFL scouts.
He got up under the center, Nateel Perry.
Yeah, lowered the pad level, got underneath, and then did a big arm swipe of the running back's legs to make that tackle right at the line of scrimmage.
He's a good one. I mean, when you talk about some of the people who've come through here, Kendall Langford and Jackie Bates. Justin Durant. In fact, Justin Durant is here today because the Jacksonville Jaguars have a bye week this week as Ellis comes up with a stop-on Moment.
He may have some company join him in the NFL. Yeah. Kendrick Ellis making plays like this. Watch the recognition. Okay, double team. I can't get. Oh, it's a screen. Chase him down and make the tackle in the backfield. That's why Ellis coming into this contest had 12 tackles for losses. We'll make it 13. Good play there.
Yeah. But you got a chance to run into Justin Durant. Also saw Zurio Smith, a young man who played here, was quite a receiver and a kick returner here a few years ago for
some of the legends. Part.
Yeah, they're in attendance.
Give them credit with, taking this program to the next level. Mm-hmm. I mean, Hampton was probably one of the first team in decades to win three MEAC championships in a row. Durant had plenty to do with that.
So a timeout has been called. This is by Bethune. Let's look at the standings once again and talk about how important this game is and the schedule that some of these teams have coming up and who maybe has the toughest schedule ahead.
I mean, you see it right there. So you've got the logjam. All four teams within one game of first place. Mm-hmm. So the key becomes, well, who's playing who? So, but, and if we look at all four of these teams, I think, in my opinion, I think we seem to agree that the toughest road to haul is going to be Florida A&M.
Right.
Because they got to play a very tough Hampton team right now, plus Bethune-Cookman.
The thing for Hampton, though, is this is their last home game.
Yes.
Everything for them is on the road from this point on. And it doesn't get easy when you go on the road in the MEAC.
And you're going down to the Jake. You're going to Tallahassee, which for years is one of the toughest places to win a MEAC conference game.
That was taking a look at the road ahead presented by Lexus. And you see, as you said, what Bethune has left. They'll be home against Howard, your school. It's doing a fantastic job of losing this year. And
oh, that was low, Charlie. That was low. You are no longer welcome on the campus of the Mecca.
7:42 to go.
Oh!
Almost a great catch down the middle by the intended receiver. That was Reeves.
But I'll tell you, there's one guy in that secondary for Hampton that hits like
Ricardo
that.
Ricardo Silva. Yeah, he's the leader.
Playing free safety, coming right in front of him. Great angle of pursuit to dislodge the wide receiver from the ball. Tony Wilson's going to remember that hit right there. I think Silva hit him so hard, he might have given himself a little stinger.
So we bring up a 4th-and-11 situation and a punting situation for, there's Silva going off to the sideline. Well, he hits, they say, they can't say enough about him. They say he's the key to the secondary. He was a defensive player of the week in the conference against North Carolina Central. In fact, he had a 68-yard interception that he returned for a touchdown. This is Isaiah Thomas trying to pick this one up, and he's out of bounds on the far sideline. 7:29, time remaining, third quarter in this four-point game on homecoming 2010 as the Mascots chill here at Armstrong Stadium. We'll be back. That's next Saturday, the 10:30 group, Nevada at Fresno. Nevada ranked number 23rd in the nation.
Colin Kaepernick, that's all you need to say.
Yeah,
enough said,
that's enough, huh?
Say. Yeah, he's worth staying up late for. On the East Coast.
And again, the running game with Chisholm, not much going on right there as the defensive Bethune stiffens with 7:18 to go.
You know, and I'm thinking, you know, how do you score right now from Hampton? Quarterback's not really able to move around. They know you're going to run the ball. Defense is crowding the line of scrimmage. Try some type of flea flicker pass.
Well,
or something
they tried
like
a little screen out, a little flanker screen out to the near side to Javaris Brown. And he picks up about 8 yards on the play. And gets the ball across midfield into Bethune territory at the 46.
Because it seems as if they have to figure out a way to soften up the Wildcat defense.
Well, one of the things you look at both of these teams is this doesn't go anywhere as the defense comes in and makes a great stop defensively. That's Ryan Lewis, the leading tackler on this Bethune team, the middle linebacker.
Yeah, he just shot through the gap. You know. Take a look. He sees where it's going. Read recognition comes over there. He beats the running back to the actual hole that the play was designed to go to. So,
but I was going to say, you know, both of these teams try this hurry-up offense to try to catch the defense snapping, and it hasn't seemed to work today, has it?
No. You know, they did that. It seemed like the offensive line didn't recognize they didn't have time to call out their blocking assignments.
So from midfield for the second straight time, Hampton punts it away. And the return is back to the 25-yard line. Tuesday, ESPNU's latest college football show. It's called The Experts, with host Lowell Belindo and the experts providing unfiltered conversation about the hot topics in college football. The Experts on ESPNU Tuesday at 1 Eastern. And in case you miss it at 1 o'clock, you can see it again on an encore presentation at 7 p.m. Eastern. Look at the BCS standings. That's some of the things they'll be talking about. How about the big game today between Utah and TCU? That game is in Utah. I think TCU's lost its last three times they've gone down there.
Yeah, that'll be the tough one. I mean, you know, Alabama just sitting there waiting for the teams above them to just start playing each other one by one.
Right. You got to figure somebody's going to lose. Matt Johnson, the little quick out pattern, and he has it complete. And it's Poole on the reception.
The one thing you can say about this Bethune-Cookman offense, although they've been able to have no offensive rhythm, so to speak, they haven't turned the ball over.
Right.
You know, so often you see offenses that struggle, then they start pressing and they put the ball on the ground.
Well, you look at all the 16 points that Bethune has up there, it all is a result of turnovers by this Hampton team.
Yes.
If they don't turn the ball over, there's no points on the board for Bethune right now.
Yep.
First down and 10, Matt Johnson. And he just fell down. He just said, let me just lay down here because I'm going to get in trouble if I try to stay up here.
Yeah, I mean, credit to this Pirate defense. I mean, they thought if we put pressure on him that he may kind of just tuck it in a little bit prematurely and panic a little bit. And I think you've seen him. You see those extra hits that they could have called. He was down and bodies all over him. So they clearly intimidated Matthew Johnson, throwing him off his game. And Keith Gauguin is a defensive coordinator looking at there. He's done a good job of inspiring his defense. Joe Paul will be proud of it, Keith.
Yeah.
You've got to play in good physical football from the linebacker position.
This is a quarterback keeper. This is a design play all the way, and a flag goes down. We may have holding against the offense. That's what it is, preliminary indication. It is going to be holding. Our referee, Darrell Davis.
Holding. Offense, number 70. 10-yard penalty, second down.
And that was Nateel Curry, the center. And guess who's holding?
Well, you know, you're going one-on-one. You'll grab a little jersey.
Yeah, that's don't let him get your quarterback.
Yeah, that's the way to stop. Now, as a quarterback, I don't mind doing that. You know, you got offensive linemen not letting the quarterback get hit. But it's a This one there, you put a one-on-one coach. You know, he's going against a grown man, as they like to say.
It is third down and 15, ball at the 34-yard line. Matt Johnson again working from the gun. Spins out of the grasp of Pegues, has a complete on the near sideline. Still going to be about 5 yards short of a first down. They're calling it incomplete. So it was in the hands of Reams, but I think he was out of bounds when he made the catch. So it'll bring up fourth and 15 in a punting situation.
Yeah, you see Pegues coming around the corner, 100 miles an hour. Matt Johnson calmly spins outside of the pocket, but leads his wide receiver Reams a little bit too far outside. The incomplete pass.
Kowalski punting once again. High snap. Gets it off.
Shanked it.
Yeah, well, he did get it off. It was better than the one he had that went backward on him earlier. And it's at the 45-yard line. Don't forget to join ESPN in support of our troops, wounded warriors, and their families. All you have to do is donate $10 by texting USO to 27722 or go to www.uso.org. Charlie Neal along with Jay Walker. 4:26, the time remaining third quarter in a four-point ball game here on Homecoming 2010 in Hampton, 16-12. And what do you tell your Hampton team right now?
I mean, if you're happy, you say all we need to do is just stay in this game and one guy make a guy miss, and we can grab the lead. But I think if you're Bethune Cookman, and you saw Brian Jenkins there, he's saying we've got to do better on special teams.
Yeah.
You know, their goals are to make it to the postseason. If they play special teams like this in the postseason, it'll vary.
And here again is Isaiah Thomas going around the left side. We've seen that play work both ways so far this afternoon. They've run him quite a bit from his wide receiver position, and he's picked up some pretty good yards on that one.
And the bad thing for Bethune Cookman is by them not being able to put points on the board offensively, you're allowing Hampton just to stay around. So
and do what they
want to do.
Not allowing them to, making them throw the ball.
Yeah.
Because as long as they feel they can run the ball and stay within striking distance, they're going to do that.
They're going to do it. Take their time. You know, they've already crossed midfield. Take their time and see if they can just deflate the clock and maybe get one score and drive together.
Here's a pass play going upstairs. And this one is way incomplete.
Way.
Ain was the intended receiver.
Ball hit 10 yards
out of bounds. Well, you know.
10 yards out of bounds?
But
you can overthrow 10
yards
downfield.
But you've got to be able to plant. And if your ankle is bothering you, you're not going to plant, right?
I'll tell you, when you miss a wide receiver by that much, then your quarterback, your offensive coordinator, is not going to call any pass plays for you. He threw that straight out of bounds. So now you're very limited what you can do. If you've got a quarterback not able to plant and make accurate throws.
This is a third and three. Looking to the sideline. And the ball was snapped badly, and Legree had to fall on it. They're going to call a false start, and that's going to probably be declined.
5 yard pick. Remains third down.
Why would... Oh, they let the play, they whistled the play dead. Okay.
That might have been a favor.
Yeah, they may get lucky and pick
convert,
up the first down.
It would be a favor.
So it'll be third down and eight now rather than third and three.
Did you see Legree's body English after that there? I mean, from a quarterback, I think that's something you've got to work on. We've seen him twice this year. When things don't go well, his body English just says, come on, man, like, you know, it's not my fault, let's do it. But as a quarterback, you can't do that. You've got to stay cool, calm, and collected.
Hampton only 7 yards here in the second half. Here's Steve Robinson, though. Picks up the first down and more. He's down the sideline. He's going to the house. Touchdown, Hampton. Steve Robinson, 51 yards. His second touchdown run of the day.
They've gone with the senior. The
so that penalty, you see what happened on that false start?
See,
it helped.
The penalty helped him out. Misdirection, good block on the left side. Poor angle being made by the defensive back for Bethune Cookman. That was number 27. Daniel Rhodes missed the tackle. You miss a tackle from your cornerback that's on outside contain. It just looked to me as if Rhodes came up there very timid. Didn't want to make contact with the power running back.
So Hernandez on for the point after.
Oh, wow. That could have been big. That could have put him up by three.
Now it's a two-point ball game, 18-16, if they missed the extra point. Here's the run by Robinson.
Watch Rose right there. I mean, that angle right there, he didn't come up there trying to take out his legs. He didn't want to make the hard tackle. He wants an arm tackle, a powerful running back. And he made one little step move and got to the end zone.
Now let's look and see, did Robinson step out of bounds going down that left sideline? That was very close right there. But again, we don't have replay, and we've got the head linesman and the side judge looking at the feet, and they didn't think he did, so it doesn't matter what we think. It's 18-16.
Yeah, you know, he's a freight rail runner. You know, one thing about those freight trains, you know, they don't corner too well. That was close.
Robinson with 75 yards and two touchdowns, and of course Chisholm over 120 yards rushing today. Hampton again with the lead. They had this before that play. I just said they'd only had 7 yards here in the second half, and then they go 51 yards on that one. Here's the ensuing kickoff. Here's Keith on the return. Keith bounces to the outside. Still on his feet. Trips and is across midfield and out of bounds in front of the Hampton bench out at about the 45-yard line. So a good return for Courtney Keith, who's averaging 23 yards per return.
Yeah, we got a wedge right there set up on the left side. And once he makes a guy miss, it becomes a foot race to the outside. And he's one block away from taking this thing to the end zone for a touchdown. And special team woes continue for both ball squads.
Yeah, that's been an issue. Back to Hampton allowed A&T to return a kickoff 85 yards for a touchdown. And Bethune allowed Morgan to return 193 yards, so they both have given up long kickoff returns for scores this year. With under 3 minutes to go here in the third quarter after that 7-yard gain, it is second down and three. Isidore Jackson. And Jackson has the first down, and the late flag comes in. Let's see who that's against. Looks like this is going to be against Hampton. You know, Bethune came in as the most penalized team.
Personal foul. Late
hit against Hampton. But Bethune came in as the most penalized team in the conference, averaging just under 100 yards a game in penalties. So.
And that's why I thought defensive discipline was going to be the key. Could they have the discipline to not get penalized in the game that meant so much? And you know, they started off with some silly fouls early in the contest, but since then they've made some adjustments, and Hampton has helped them out several times. Poor defensive choices get penalized.
Matt Johnson handing off. Here's Moment trying to turn the corner, and he takes people with him as he finally is run out of bounds. And the man who had to run him out of bounds was Butts, number two for Hampton University. So Moment goes out, Isidore Jackson back in, and it's second down and 8.
Yeah. They're on the move right now, and you know, Hampton, you got to be thinking, let's keep them out of the end zone at all costs. I don't think they'll make a field goal try, so play calling selection becomes a little different for the defensive coordinator to make a little bit more passes.
Matt Johnson over the middle has a complete to Francois, but Francois is swallowed up by Darius Johnson, the middle linebacker.
Yeah, that's there. That was one time we've seen Francois actually look like a former quarterback. You know, he makes a reception, then he just stops his feet. One thing you can't do is stop your feet. Mitch Dry, watch this. He's going to turn. He sees him coming. And
you go
for a ride.
Yeah.
Yeah. Keep those legs turning one way or another.
Third down and about 2. Again, handoff to Isidore Jackson.
He didn't get it. Now you got to make
down.
A choice.
Yeah.
Now you make a choice. You know, what do you do in this situation here?
I'd go for it. I mean, you've struggled in the kicking game.
Yeah, field goal gives you the lead.
Yeah, but
any chance you get to get the lead, you got to think of it.
All right, coach.
Fundamentally.
All right, coach.
If your all kicker can't make.
See, that's why I'm not a coach. I'm not. You were a quarterback. I know what you would have said, let's go for it.
I just want the lead. You do whatever you can to get the lead, whether it's by 1 point or 3 points.
This is a 28-yard field goal attempt by Kulkowski, who kicked one earlier. This one is up, and this is no good. They get all the way down to the 11-yard line, and they attempt the 28-yard field goal, and there's a player down, and that is Kendrick Ellis. Not good news right now. So earlier, he missed, that is Kulkowski, or Kowalski rather, a 33-yard field goal. He missed. He hit on a 23-yarder, and he just missed on a 28-yarder, an opportunity to give his team the lead. So Hampton takes over, and Ellis looks like he's okay. He comes off under his own power.
I mean, but that's disappointing. I mean, those have to be automatics.
Yes, they
do. Anything less than 30 yards is automatic. You know, more times than not, anything less than 37 yards has to be automatic. They just really have some problems with their kicking game there. And we said it a week ago, one thing that may be their Achilles heel would be the kicking game and special teams. And
the longest field goal they've kicked this year was a 27-yarder, and that was under Sven Hurd against North Carolina Central. Here's Steve Robinson again going off the left side, the man who has a pair of touchdowns and almost around 80-some yards in rushing so far in this ball game.
I mean, they found some success on the touchdown run, running to the left side. Well, why not go back there? Seems like Scott Nichols, the left tackle, is winning his matchup against Ryan Davis over there.
So Steve Robinson out of Buford, Georgia, went to Georgia Military Academy, where when he was there, he rushed for over 1,100 yards and 20 touchdowns. So he's accustomed to getting into the
fumble
end zone. And there's a ball on the ground, and it looks like Bethune has it again.
Now the ground caused that one. But they're not going to say it that way. When he went and hit towards the ground, the ball popped up. And you can tell by the way it popped up that it was the ground that hit it.
Now let's look at it once again.
This is
Isaiah Thomas.
Oh,
no,
I'm
the
wrong.
Ball was coming out. No, you were wrong, Jay, for once.
I was wrong.
For once. So this is the fifth turnover of the day for the fifth turnover for Hampton University. You cannot afford to turn the ball over five times. And three of the previous four, Bethune has been able to put some points on the board. From the 26 this time, they keep it on the ground and nothing doing.
Now the good news for Hampton is if your defense can make a stop, you know, in this case, you know, they can probably give up one first down and still hold on to their lead. You know, if you're Bethune-Cookman, you
especially
be
if you
thinking,
ask them to kick a field goal.
So if you're for Bethune-Cookman, you got to be thinking we got to go to the end zone. You know, you've got to be going towards the end zone, thinking this is four down territory.
Ellis is not in there. Now that, you remember he wasn't in there. He got hurt at the previous series. He came out of his own power, wasn't in there for that play. We'll see what happens. 15 minutes of football left here in Hampton. Well, let's take a look at our game summary, and it's brought to you by State Farm. And, of course, Hampton University, Steven Robinson, 81 yards in rushing and a couple of touchdowns. Matt Johnson, 111 yards passing and a touchdown. And Hampton, Kendrick Ellis, 9 tackles and a tackle for loss. Let's look at Mr. Kendrick Ellis as he worked today. Okay.
I mean, he's been very active all over the football field, chasing down Wildcat defenders. He's definitely proved he's as good as advertised.
Meanwhile, Eddie Poole with the reception. And he picks up a first down for Bethune as they move to James. Here's a young man that transferred. In fact, he's wearing number 3, the same number that Weems wore a couple years ago. So, new faces in the lineup. First and goal at the 8-yard line for Bethune. Red zone, Isidore Jackson. And Jackson takes it down close to the goal line. They're calling it touchdown now. Or did they? No, a second. Okay, I saw official put 2 arms up here on the near side. And I didn't think he was. He's around the 4-yard line. Isidore Jackson again. And he takes it down to about the two. So it'll be third down and goal at the two-yard line for Bethune Cookman.
Opportunity for the defense to try and make a stop. Keep in mind that an extra point or a field goal attempt is not a gimme from this range for Bethune Cookman.
No, it isn't. Matt Johnson, Isidore Jackson, he's in there this time. He takes it in from 2 yards out. He dove into the end, so he really didn't have to dive. The hole was there for him. So with 13:43 to go, Bethune regains the lead. Up 22-18.
Yeah, just give it to him. Nice crease up the middle, but he wasn't going to chance anything. Took off and elevated and got into the end zone for the touchdown.
And now Kowalski on for the point after. The adventure continues. Let's see what happens now. He made it. Just made it. So it's a 5-point ball game now with Bethune up 23-18. Here's Isidore Jackson. Takes it in from 2 yards out. We'll be back. ESPNU College Football Primetime is presented by McDonald's. I'm loving it. And in part by 5-Hour Energy. Hours of energy now, no 2:30 feeling later. For more information, visit 5hourenergy.com. 13:43 the time remaining. Charlie Neal, Jay Walker here, Hampton University for homecoming 2010. And Bethune Cookman just regained the lead. All 23 points that Bethune has put on the board, as you look at the preseason conditioning, is called chaos that Coach Brian Jenkins put his team through when he before spring ball this year. But all 23 points that they put up has been a result of the turnovers by Hampton. They've turned the ball over five times. Four times Bethune was able to capitalize.
Many times that's the difference between a championship team and a middle of the pack team. The championship team, they will struggle at times, but they won't hurt themselves by putting points on the board and creating the turnovers. So give credit to them for not turning over the football and taking advantage of the Pirate offense whenever they made a mistake.
So Isaiah Thomas not getting an opportunity to return this kickoff as the ball is kicked out of the end zone by Kowalski.
And all that being said, I mean, this Pirate offense does not look good. They turned the ball over. They're down by 5 points. I mean, if they can get it together, you know, you've got to take that defensive back mentality. Forget about what happened the previous three quarters.
Right.
Get out there and put it together now.
Because people are going to remember what you did at the end of the game. Yes. Just like September, October, right?
Yes. You know, what's John Elway known for?
Comeback.
Comeback, but in order to have a comeback, you had to be trailing. So he can throw three interceptions, but come back and throw that touchdown to win it. That's what you're looking for in your quarterback. You're hoping that the Greek can get it going and forget about the previous plays and come out and get a spark and get a drive going.
And a flag is going to stop everything before we get started. Do we have too many men in there on the field?
Prior to the snap, illegal substitution on the defense, 12 men on the field. 5-yard penalty, first down.
That was against Bethune, most penalized team in the conference. Another 5-yard penalty against them, so it'll be first and five for Hampton University. They get the ball at their own 25-yard line now.
Now let that be the spark. You got first and five. Go for a little double move. Try and get yourself a big play on first and down. First down with less than 5 yards to go.
The last possession started at their own 20. They fumbled at the 26. This time, here's the running back. It looked like a horse collar there for a minute, or a face mask on Chisholm as he takes it. It is a flag down. With 13:38 to go. Now they wave it
off. There's no foul for a face mask.
We both thought it was.
Let's see, do we see a face mask? He's coming through.
No, it wasn't. It's just the way he went down. Again, visible on the call. You know, you looked at Coach Brian Jenkins standing over there, and he came in here and instilled a winning attitude into this Bethune Cookman squad. You know, and that winning attitude more than just lifted the spirit of the school and the student body, it also spilled over into the community.
I mean, definitely so. And I mean, keep in mind, he's replacing one of the legendary coaches
down there.
You know, Alvin Wyatt, big personality, big clothes, big attitude, you know, big program.
Right.
You know, then you come in and have to feel behind him, and I think he's just gone about the right way. Just we're going to be work. We're going to work hard, work hard.
No more Wyatt Bone, and the quarterback Legree is smart enough to just go down. And now a late flag comes up, and this may be for celebration. Let's see what this is all about.
After the play, personal foul, unnecessary roughness on the defense, 15-yard penalty, first down.
See, those are the type of mistakes that make coaches lose their hair and stay up late at night. Brian Jenkins.
Well, we said we wanted to have disciplined defense, and this right here is showing the lack of discipline. Quarterback can't go anywhere. He's down. Come in there.
Yeah.
Come on.
Number 90 comes in there and just piles on him for no reason at all. Jameel Farrington, Jr. from Homestead High in Miami.
So you've got a negative play in which the quarterback was going to be tackled for a loss behind the line of scrimmage. Now you get automatic first down, keep the drive alive.
First and 10 at the 44 now. So now instead of them punting the ball away, the penalty for unnecessary roughness, late hit. Here's the quarterback with a flank of screen onto the right side to Javaris Brown, but he has nowhere to go right now as the defense tightens up. Maybe back to the line of scrimmage, and that's it.
And that was almost a lateral. At what point, you know, they said Isaiah Thomas would be their emergency quarterback. Mm-hmm. At what point do you just not, do you allow Legree to get in shotgun and just throw? I mean, you're trying to do the handoff. They've caught on to that. So I think at this point, you use his mental mindset because he didn't have it all there physically and just say, we're going to call pass plays and just go with his pre-snap read. I mean, as a pocket passer, you can get away with a pre-snap read.
And one of the things you know he's not going to do is what he normally does is get outside the pocket to try to run. Just because of his physical ability. So it's a false start. They were not set before the ball was snapped.
Offense, number 70. 5-yard penalty, second down.
Jamal
Correction.
Lewis.
Number 7.
Maybe it wasn't Jamal Lewis. But it's still a penalty against Hampton University. Neither team has been artistic when it comes to penalties today. Hampton 9 penalties, Bethune 6.
Yeah, I mean, you know, in the play it just kind of rapidly deteriorated in the second half, and Hampton offense hasn't been able to do anything at all.
Legree, back to pass, has a complete, and it's complete to Brown on the far sideline, right in front of Bethune bench, but it's still going to be about 7 yards short of a first down.
But you have a chance by doing that. You know, if you put him in the pocket, you've got a chance. If he's going to get hit, you don't want the hits on the quarterback. But the fact of the matter is you can just make a good decision and just pick a team apart. The question is, does Legree have the football IQ, football mentality to pick a defense apart from the pocket?
Trip receivers on the near side, the bottom of your screen. We have all the receivers down there. Davis is down there. Here's Legree, throws a screen to the far side, and Bethune was not fooled at all. They were not fooled at all as they stayed home because they had trip receivers to the left side.
Yeah, you got to take him out. I mean, now he's playing too ginger. Look, I mean, this right here, that's a tippy toe. You got to take him out. I mean, you know, hate to say it, he's trying to tough it out for all the right reasons, but right now he's a detriment to your team offensively. So I think you got to, you know, he won't pull himself out. Of course, he's going to tell you he can tough it out, but right now you're getting nothing from the quarterback position. You basically got the defense playing 11 versus 10.
I mean, you would go to what as a high snap. And the ball will die right at about the 31-yard line. 10:24 to go. And when we come back, we'll take a look at what's going on around the HBCU. South Carolina State, they're trying to stay in the hunt. They're rooting for Bethune today. We'll be back in a moment. Well, while we were away, we had a penalty against Bethune for making contact with an official. And there's, I think the official got tripped up. Look at the top left of your screen on the sideline.
Oh.
And who is that? That's not even a coach, is it?
Is that a Wildcat cameraman official?
Cameraman. So, I mean, I don't see. I don't. He's not even part of the coaching staff. He just happened to be down there taking pictures, and they call sideline interference on Bethune. He's not even part of their crew. So, that, I mean, I guess because he's on their sideline, you've got to police that. And that's what Brian Jenkins is arguing, and the official tripped over him going down the field.
But so,
again.
I mean, are you responsible for somebody? You're away. I understand if you're at home. You're on the road. We're in Hampton, so how can they control outsiders on the sideline?
How do you know that he's part of Bethune's?
Wow.
Yeah, that's pretty rough.
I've seen it all, Charlie.
Officiating.
I've seen that.
But the lights have gone out. But the officiating has been a little suspect over the last couple weeks. Some things we've seen.
I love your explanation on that one. I mean, you're on the road. I understand if you're at home, it's your home.
I thought it was a coach or something when I saw the guy with the cameras. He could be from a local newspaper. He just happens to have on the state colors as Bethune. It is second down and 8. Ball at the 18-yard line. Matt Johnson rolls to the right. Throws in the middle, and it's incomplete. Francois never turned around, and the closest man to it for Hampton was Jacoby Finner. So it'll bring up a third down situation with 9:44 to go.
Well, that could be one of the turning points of this game. You know, if the Pirates can make a stop right here on defense and force Bethune to punt from within their own 10-yard line, be great field position.
You know, Matt Johnson was tried to, I should say Brian Jenkins tried to recruit Matt Johnson like 5 years ago when he was at Louisiana Lafayette.
Yep.
And they didn't want him. The people above Brian Jenkins said, nah, he's too small, we don't want him. So he winds up coming to Bethune, and Brian Jenkins is happy that he didn't get him back then and he's here now. And he looks like he just got him a first down.
Yeah, that was what you call a first down scamper. Quick decision was made, and they actually just, I mean, that's what they talk about. Well, he likes to run for the sidelines. He likes to slide. Well, to me, that's smart football. You know, he realized exactly how many yards he needed, went out there, got the yardage. Don't take the hit at the end of the run. Go ahead, get out of bounds. If you got the first down, you're more valuable to your team playing than you are injured.
Johnson did struggle with the wide bone for a while, and that's why you saw them platooning him between him and Francois a year ago as Isidore Jackson takes the call. But, you know, he was happy to see Brian Jenkins come in this year and come in with the offense that he did because he's more suited to this type of an offense.
Yeah, and when you talk to the offensive staff for Bethune, you ask them, why were you able to have all the success you've had this year? They said, well, we had a quarterback here. You know, we knew we wanted to change systems. We didn't know if we would have a quarterback that could run the system we wanted to run. And fortunately for Coach Jenkins, Matthew Johnson stepped up to the plate and was more than capable of running this Mark Orlando offensive attack.
8:41 to go. Isidore Jackson breaks through, still running, keeping his legs churning. 8:34 to go. Don't forget, we ask you to log on to Facebook.com /ESPNU. And become a fan. And our question was, should there be an HBCU national championship game? And Jay kind of explained what was happening, and we looked at it. As soon as this play is over, we'll tell you what your response was and how you responded to that Facebook question. First down and 10 at the 36-yard line. Bethune trying to eat up some clock right now, leading in by 5. Jackson loses a couple yards on this play. Let's first of all look at some of the past champions, past HBCU champions, South Carolina State Grambling. These are sure to bowl. And the ones that are highlighted with Hampton were also the year where the American Sports Wire felt Hampton was the black national champion, along with North Carolina Central. And we'll see what you think on this second down and 11 play after a loss of 1 by Isidore Jackson. They like that Moment in there in the lineup right now. Jonathan Moment, number 44, 220-pounder. Sophomore from Orlando, Florida, 7:25. They're milking that clock. Now they're going to call a timeout.
Timeout. Bethune Cookman.
That's their second timeout.
Second charge timeout of the half.
So let's look at that Facebook question.
You know, I think we go back to the champions. If you go each of those years, I can tell you there was some controversy. You know, let's talk about 2008 when Grambling won. South Carolina State won their first MAC championship. Many people thought that they were the best team in black college football. You know, then you talk about the team last year, 2009, South Carolina State was awarded. There were many people who felt that Prairie View was the best team with only one loss for the season. So,
right.
And then Tuskegee, anytime Tuskegee wins it or Division II school wins it, you always got some of the big boys in the Division
I. Unless you look at what's happening this year, even in the Sheridan poll, they have not allowed Bethune to be the number one team this year.
Yep.
It's been Grambling, even though Grambling has one loss.
Grambling has one loss, but that was to a FBS school. So
right.
Typically the pollsters or the voters give you a pass on that one if you lose to one of the larger schools. I mean, South Carolina State was number one most of the season until they
but
lost.
But there's another network, the Box to Row, and then also HSRN that has put Bethune up at number one.
Yes.
Here's Matt Johnson. Flag is down. And he runs out of bounds. You know, when I played, I used to say you run out of bounds and stop the clock.
Yeah.
I said, no. You run out of bounds
to
preserve yourself. Those clocks are still ticking in those stadiums.
Yes.
I'm not playing anymore.
Offside. Defense, number 35. 5-yard penalty. Second down.
And that scamper there, you know, on that run, you know, he did such a good job running, picked up 5 yards, stepped out of bounds. But, you know, when you got quarterback running, you got Ellis coming out because he was winded. He tried to chase him 20 yards downfield. Couldn't do it, so.
And that's unusual to see him come out of a lineup.
Yeah.
He normally stays in there whole game. And it's second down, and we'll call it 6 after the 5-yard offside penalty. Matt Johnson standing in there, throws, has it complete, short of a first down, and it's Eddie Poole on the reception. Here's Kendrick Ellis today.
Yeah, I would think he deserves a little breather. I mean, he's been playing hard there. You see him being the run stopper in the middle. Second effort even from his knees, making the tackle, following the screen play, snipping it out, and then going to make the tackle. This is the motor they talk about. Then he gets double teamed, but he still doesn't give up. Gets up in the air, tries to disrupt the quarterback's vision to the pass. So he deserves a little rest after that. When you're that active, you're talking about a man that weighs 6'5", 330 pounds. But that type of motor, that normally says NFL on it, doesn't it?
11 tackles, 1.5 for loss. And here's Isidore Jackson right up the middle where the space was vacated by Kendrick Ellis. They get the first down, they move the chains, and the clock continues to roll. As you look at this Bethune-Cookman team, and there you look at Brian Jenkins, and you talk about the fact that he's a young guy, 38 years of age, and he's been in a number of programs, and he says the guy who's had the most influence over him is Greg Schiano up at Rutgers University.
Yeah, that was surprising considering that he'd been with Schiano probably the least number of years.
1 year.
Compared to the other programs he's been to, but you know, just they learned so much from Schiano, the professionalism and how to get things done, and I can tell you what, he's learned how to inspire programs, much like Schiano did, having to breathe some life into that Rutgers program in New Jersey.
Prior to the snap. Delay of game. Offense, 5-yard penalty, remains first down.
So first and 15, the ball moved back from midfield to inside the 45 to the 44-yard line.
This is weird to see the Bethune-Cookman offense in you know, hold on to the ball in a milk the clock type mode. It's something we're not
used because
to.
They're so used to tempo. Yeah,
they
you talk about a play clock. It's like the shot clock in basketball. They, you know, they don't let it get down under 20 seconds.
Yeah, they don't need it.
They shot it up there. Yep. Here's Isidore Jackson again going straight ahead. South Carolina State and Florida A&M both came out victorious today. So updating the standings, South Carolina State at 5-1, FAMU at 5-1. It could be a three-way tie into this day. It could be a four-way tie at the end of this day. We'll see what happens.
So South Carolina State won today. So that means they beat Howard. Hey, I didn't see that one.
The thing is, what's the score? Y'all didn't even have any academics today. There's Kendrick Ellis back in the lineup and making a stop on the running back.
Ellis comes in, you know, when big guys get their win, they seem to give that extra effort. You know, that was a good call by the defensive coordinator realizing where they're going to try to run the ball. He ran just a hard slant, kind of like what they call a two-gap technique, and made the tackle. A huge, huge play coming up right here for Hampton. They're going to get back in the football game. They need to make a stop on this third and 11.
Third down and long. 4:17 to go. Matt Johnson, he's going to take off. And now he's going to run, and he's going to be knocked out of bounds very short of the first down. He had to get all the way down to about the 41-yard line, and he's going to be dropped at about the 47, 48. Actually, they're going to mark it at the 49-yard line. So it'll bring up a fourth down. Fourth and about 7 or 8.
And if you're the Hampton Pirates, I think this is the time you bring out your punt block.
Oh, yeah.
The offense is really struggling. Bethune Cookman should be very careful inside the trenches on this punt protection.
This time, Kowalski, a good punt. And the catch is made by Isaiah Thomas, but he's not going to get very far as he's brought down by Chris Perry. Let's look at the HBCU headlines. Of course, the top 100 NFL players were named this week, and guess who was number one?
He was number one.
Number one at the top of the list.
Jerry, I knew he would be high, number one.
Jerry Rice from Mississippi Valley, alum, led the list with, you know, a 100, number one. South Carolina State names a football field after Willie Jeffries,
Coach
and
Jay.
Rightfully so. And Dawson Stadium is now Dawson Stadium with Willie Jeffries Field. Coached the Bulldogs for 19 seasons. And then, of course, the MEAC released their 2011 basketball schedule for TV, which will be here on ESPNU. A number of Monday night games, some Saturday action also. And of course, on the men's side, and that pass complete. Todd Bozeman's Morgan State team picked to repeat. Hampton on the winning side is picked to win it all.
We got a good one here. This is shaping up here. The Pirates, they need a sparking. They just don't feel it. I just get the feeling that this crowd doesn't even think the Pirate offense can move the ball down the field. Let's see what they've got.
LeGree coming off the bench in relief of Bynes, struggling with his offensively, and we may have had a turnover here. I haven't seen the officials say anything.
Called an incomplete pass.
Oh, they call it incomplete. Okay.
Tell you what, regardless if this is a turnover or not, Chisholm is going to have to answer the coach about the ball leaving his body too many times.
Yeah. Slater was right there on top of it, but they're saying the ball was incomplete, so the new life for Hampton.
It's a little bit too quick getting there. A little bit too quick getting there.
They can still breathe. It's 3 minutes remaining on the clock, and 18 points on the board for Hampton, 23 for Bethune. Shotgun LeGree. This time Chisholm trying to go to the right side. Nothing doing there as coming up from his cornerback is Slater to make the stop.
Yeah, they go right back to Chisholm, so they're trying to let the freshman running back play through his growing pains.
Well, he's done a great job for them over the years. I mean, you know, he had to replace a kid like LaMarcus Coker, who had over 1,000 yards for his Hampton team a year ago, and he's done a pretty good job. Mayhew up at down in North Carolina A&T is the 1,000-yard rusher in the conference this year. This one is caught, and it's going to be enough for a first down by Javaris Brown. He moves the sticks across the 40-yard line, so we're going to have a dynamic finish here. One thing we do know is Hampton has to get into the end zone. They cannot settle for a field goal.
Yeah, that won't work. And it all starts with the offensive line giving time for LeGree to throw the ball. Now, to combat that, look for Bethune-Cookman to try and bring some pressure to get to the quarterback to force him to move around.
First and 10. LeGree steps up, throws, intercepted. No, hits the ground. It was in and out of the hands of number 30 there defensively for the Wildcats of Bethune, and that's Chris Perry.
This ball was poorly thrown, deflected, tipped. Oh, he almost got that off the ground.
Yes, he did.
That would have been a fantastic interception had he been able to hold off.
Second down and 10 at the 42. Under 2 minutes to go. Clock stopped on the incompletion. Blanker screen out in the flat and nothing doing. I'll tell you, they read that very well. Chris Perry again was there to read the reception in Javaris Brown when he went in motion.
So they tried one of these little bunch formations to get wide receivers out there as lead blockers, but too much speed. Inside man did a great job of breaking penetration.
I saw Chris Perry, the backup strong safety, him and R.P. Smith, doing a good job on that left side with a minute 25 to go. This is a 3rd and 9 for Hampton. Incomplete. Steve Robinson, the intended receiver, coming out of the backfield, streaking down the left side was McCain. But of course, LeGree never got a chance to look over this way. So this is it. Fourth down. 4th and 9 with a minute 20 to go.
Yeah, that's a tough one there, because if he hits Robinson, then Robinson would have picked up the first down and then some. It's not a well-thrown ball. And I know he's giving it all the heart he has, but when you don't have your legs underneath you, the one thing that you lose first is the accuracy.
This is the ball game for Hampton right now. This could be their last play of this contest, or can they keep the drive alive? It's a 4th and 9 at their own 43 with a minute 20 to go, trailing by 5. LeGree under pressure, and he's still on his feet. Lets it go. Caught for first down.
On one leg, Charlie.
On one leg, he managed to keep that one alive, and he got it complete. And look at him. He can have just about get back on the field.
Like Byron Leftwich, they need to go carry him. We can question the accuracy of some of the throws, but don't question the young man's heart. With the defender on him, ankle gets tweaked, still delivers a strike. Oh, that's just all heart determination. He refused to go down.
And who does he hit? And that was Isaiah Thomas with the reception to change a move at the 45. The drive is alive, a minute and 11 to go in this 5-point ball game. 1st and 10 Hampton. LeGree playing on one leg, coming off the bench. This one down the sideline, and it's knocked down by Rhodes. Rhodes had a chance to pick it off, but I thought it might have bounced into the hands of McCain. It was so close, wasn't it?
Yeah, man, if he gets this ball up, you know, right there, he's got a little life into him now. Got his legs underneath him, but had that ball been about 5 yards, a little bit higher, take some of the trajectory on it, lead him upfield. The wide receivers, McCain, two wide receivers, have gotten back there.
McCain was there, number 5, number 7, Dante Davis was there. So here we go with 2nd down, and the numbers today on David LeGree, 8 of 15.
Since they have all 3 timeouts, don't be afraid to call some crossing routes. If you get man-to-man coverage, hit a guy in stride, he can make a big one for you.
Steve Robinson, on the carry. And you're saying why, right?
Now you call a timeout. Well, I guess you got the 3 you want to use them, but, you know, I'm thinking now you're trying to play 7-on-7 football.
LeGree, he's been a trooper today. Coming in relief of Herb Bynes, he's trying to rally his team.
When you join,
you're watching ESPNU College Football Primetime presented by McDonald's with under a minute to go, a 23-18 ball game, 3rd down and 7 for Hampton. LeGree under pressure, being chased, has some room to run on the left side and goes out of bounds and gets the first down, but there's a penalty marker now. He gets out of bounds at about the 32-yard line. Let's see what the marker is about. And it looks like it's going to be against Hampton. Personal foul. Illegal contact to the face. And this
personal foul. Illegal hands to the face. Number 75 in the offense. 15-yard penalty. 3rd down.
That's Trey Folks.
Look at the right side of your screen. You see him right there, number 75. Just got that hand up there, caught in the face mask. Had a double team on him. Defender was blocked. They had a double team on, but that left hand, he extended it out, was in the face mask.
His dad, Dennis, played with the Minnesota Vikings and the Miami Dolphins. had a cousin, Chucky Atkins, who's a pretty good basketball player. Played a few years in the NBA. Last year with Detroit. So it brings up a third down and about 22. A lot of real estate to go for this Hampton team. But more importantly, they have to get into the end zone. It doesn't matter if they get in field goal range. It's only 51 seconds to go. They're down by 5 points, 23-18.
They need this first down.
And this one half of it is caught. They still are short of the first down by about 2 yards or 3 yards.
Yeah, you see the leg is getting better. He's feeling a little bit better on it, warming it up, and that's just all heart and determination on that one.
Oops.
Couldn't stop. Got no breaks.
They don't want to put them on too hard either, do you? So it's a fourth down and about three or four. Fourth and four, we'll call it. This is a big play. 45 seconds
right there.
This is it. South Carolina State and Florida A&M have already won today. So in order for them to keep pace, they're going to have to put it in the end zone. Legree steps up under pressure, throws, caught, first down. No, they call it incomplete. It was in and out of the hands of Dan Allen, the tight end. He had it for a moment, or was that Steve Robinson? It was Steve Robinson. He had it for a moment, but just couldn't hold on. Here it is, up, down. When he's hit by Rhodes, he could not control it. So that's going to do it for the Hampton Pirates, barring some miracle. But what a day for this young man, and what a gutty performance for Legree to come in for Bynes, who went out with a knee injury in the first half, and he wasn't even supposed to play. He wasn't even supposed to dress today. He said, I'm just going to dress. That's what he told me yesterday, just in case. And he came on, and of course, the five turnovers didn't help the Hampton Pirates. You know, that's one of the things that hurt them. And, of course, the 23 points that Bethune put on was a result of that. Don't forget, Tuesday night, you can catch ESPNU's All Access. It's training days with the Duke Blue Devils. Get behind the scenes. Hamps look poised for another deep run. All Access training days with the Duke Blue Devils on ESPNU Tuesday at 9 p.m. For more information, log on to ESPNU.com. David Legree started his career at Syracuse University, then transferred down here, brought another couple players with him that are on this Hampton University squad. But here's David Legree. He's a junior from Brooklyn, New York. Back in Syracuse, he was at Syracuse in 07 and 08. Didn't see a whole lot of action. Family of three brothers and two sisters. Met his dad when we were up at Delaware State earlier in the year. Told me yesterday his dad was definitely going to be here for this one.
Oh, yeah, everybody wanted to be here. The eyes of the black college football world were on Hampton, Virginia in this contest, and it was a...
Let's look at Herbert Bynes. He's on crutches after the first half. Of course, Hampton, when you talk about, I don't know if it's a quarterback issue, but a quarterback problem going forward with the next couple of games for the Pirates at FAMU and against Morgan State on the road, both of those games, and how well Legree will be and who's going to be the third string guy. They talked about Isaiah Thomas being the third string quarterback for this team going forward. So it looks like Bynes is done for the season.
Yeah, well, the dream season continues for Bethune-Cookman.
Yes, it does.
For Hampton, they've got some concerns at the quarterback position, but, you know, all eyes are shaping up on Orlando, Florida. Last weekend of the college football season, you know who's playing that weekend? Florida A&M.
And Bethune.
And Bethune-Cookman. If that game wasn't big enough already.
It's really going to be big now, especially with FAMU still in the hunt.
Yes.
So that's going to be it. The final score here as we update the standings in the MEAC. Bethune goes to 9-0 overall. Remember back in 2002 when they came in here, they came in 9-0. And Hampton knocked him off, but it wasn't to be done today. As Hampton falls to 4-2, it's a tie for second between South Carolina State and FAMU. That's it from Hampton. Who gon' get a victory? It's game time. Well, let's take a look at the Lexus HBCU post-game report. And of course, Bethune-Cookman comes out a 5-point winner over Hampton University. Coach Brian Jenkins coming over to console the quarterback, Herbert Bynes from Hampton University, who got hurt early in the contest. But, Jay, turnovers the order of the day for this Hampton University team. Out of the five turnovers, Bethune was able to capitalize on four of them and put 23 points on the board.
And I think time and time again, Bethune-Cookman is showing what a quality football program they are. When their offense was struggling, hey, they relied on the other team to make the mistake, and they made them pay for it. Anytime you turn over the football five times, the good team's going to make you pay. Bethune-Cookman scored all 23 of their points off a Hampton Pirate turnover, showing you that they know how to get it done when they'll even have their A game on the road. Special teams, no matter what it was, they found a way to respond and put points on the board. They're a very good football team, and this was an impressive win to come in here on Hampton's homecoming and walk away with the victory.
And like I said, it was a championship-type atmosphere. Both teams knew what was on the line in terms of the race for the MEAC. And you look at the remaining schedule for Bethune-Cookman, they'll be home against Howard University next week, and they close out the season in Orlando in the Florida Classic against FAMU.
Yeah, the Rattlers continue just to stay somewhere right there lurking, meaning it's going to be a spectacular game in Orlando, which could be for the MEAC championship.
South Carolina State, again, was rooting for Bethune today because they're hoping if Bethune wins out, because they lost to Bethune, they'll get two teams into the FCS playoff. And once again, our final score from Armstrong Stadium, 23-18. Next, we'll send you to our Sports Center U studio. College football fans, you won't want to miss Six Experts and with unfiltered conversations every Tuesday at 1 p.m. For Jay Walker, Charlie Neal, this has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. Now let's go to Lowell Valendo in the Sports Center U studio.